Daytona. It's a twice-around-the-clock motorsports classic, the toughest, the longest, and the most important sports car race in this hemisphere. The IndyCar legends, the stock car heroes, the international driving stars are here. Each has his own agenda, but Daytona is where the big boys come to play.
We're going to win this race because we've won Indy 8 times, and we do know how to win.
Hey, this is Daytona, man. I mean, this is my racetrack. Just because you go down here and go out in the infield, I've been out in the infield all my life. I go out, I leave here going through the infield. I don't know, I can't even pronounce these guys' names. They're down here intruding on our turf.
Well, I'm afraid these colonial chaps have got the wrong idea. This is a proper sports car race, and until they win the Indy 500 in the dark and have to turn right, well, then we'll come back for more.
They've all come to Daytona, and they've all come to win. Presentation of the 24 Hours of Daytona is brought to you by Dodge, setting new standards of performance. And by BF Goodrich TA Radials. TA Radials, tested tough to make your car perform. And by Budweiser, the genuine article. Beechwood aged for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you.
Everyone, I'm Dave DeSpain at the STP Pit Communication Center. You've seen the bumper sticker. If you want a race, Daytona is the place. We have come here for a race of superlatives. Longest and toughest are the first two that come to mind. But this is much more than a race. It's the start of Speed Week, the kickoff of a new racing season. You race star folks out there in television land are as excited about this as the tens of thousands of people who have come here to savor it in person. But where is that big crowd? Well, they're certainly not here in the grandstand. They'll be jammed in there in 2 weeks for the 500, but today they're down in the infield jamming the fences. They want to get close to the action. That's the style of road racing. They want to be part of a happening that's been happening for a quarter of a century now. And we're going to get you close to the action today with two in-car cameras to help cover this event. First, the BFG Porsche that will start outside row one. You're going to get some spectacular pictures of the start. Further back in the field, the number 88 Morrison Cook Corvette with our own Bill Adam at the wheel of that racing car. Now, our TBS Sports Spotlight for the next 24 hours and 10 minutes is going to focus on people stories, the drivers, the great stars in this race. 194 men and 3 women about to start a saga, a long journey that ends right next door in Victory Lane here at Daytona. Let's meet the people who will start up front, and we start with a German, a 2-time winner of the 24 Hours of Le Mans, the pole sitter for the 24 Hours of Daytona. He's switched from Ford to Porsche. It's a bit of a surprise. Let's meet Klaus Ludwig.
Klaus, what's most important on your mind now going into the start of a 24-hour race?
I think that that we have to do 24 hours and not a sprint race. That's a complete different ball game. We have to make our pace, and in a sprint race you just give it from the first minute, and here we really have to take it easy.
Well, you've got a tough man alongside of you, a winner here before, Bob Wallach.
Well, Bob, getting a congratulation here and a good luck from Bruce Levin, your car owner last year. You've just traded cars from these two last year. You and Jochen have traded. Who got the better bargain?
We did. I think you ought to come back in about 24 hours, and I'll let you know.
Okay.
Well, that is the head of the field. Now, I want to introduce you to the broadcast stars who are going to bring you all of the action for the next 24 hours. Let's meet the TBS luminaries who make up our broadcast team here, the starting lineup for the 24 Hours of Daytona.
In pit position number one, Chris Economaki, editor-publisher of National Speed Sport News. Directly behind Economaki and challenging Jerry Garrett. As darkness descends across Daytona, the stars of the TBS night shift. Bob Varsha will strap himself into the anchor chair. Bill Hennessy will be stealing my thunder here in the STP Pit Communications Center. Promising Motorweek newcomer Bob Richards will patrol pit road, along with Steve Potter, racing editor of the New York Times and the most accident-prone racer New Jersey has ever produced. Four members of our team will drive in this race, battling for position on the track, then scrambling to their broadcast positions and vying just as ferociously for airtime. Lynn St. James, the fastest woman racer in the world, alongside Bob Aiken, Porsche owner-driver and competitive ad libber. David Hobbs is an endurance and Trans Am racing champion and well-known Mike Hogg. And Bill Adam is guaranteed even more airtime. He's driving our camera car. And on the pole for the fifth straight TBS Sports telecast of the 24 hours, a man who's never met a cliche he couldn't master, the anchorman for this exclusive live TBS telecast, Ken Squire.
Thank you, David. I think it is a perfect day for a race. Temperature in the mid-60s, dropping down to the 40s tonight, high 70s for tomorrow, and no chance of rain, they say. I think at the outset, A.J. Foyt, Darrell Waltrip, and David Hobbs really set the tone for this event. As opposed to the pure pressure coming up in 2 weeks for the Daytona 500, this one is pure pleasure, huh? What about it, Bill Adam?
Well, there really is a lot of fun in this race, and I've got double the fun today. Two out of the three things I love best in life. Broadcasting is great with you, Ken. Driving is a little bit better. Two out of three I can't lose.
All right. Let's take a look right now at the 3.56-mile course over which the 69 teams, some 200 drivers, will be competing for 24 hours.
Yep. On this ultra-fast Daytona Speedway, we've got three critical areas very, very important to making a safe race. And here is the first entering turn one. Fifth gear, 200 miles an hour, right down to a second gear, hard left-hand corner. Watch this now. We're bending through a GTP car here, trying to accelerate through, but a little kink. And look at that. Look how easy it is to get contact there. One contact, you're out of the race. The second here, we exit this corner. A tight second gear right-hander. A little bit of a straight, but it's what's ahead of us. It's very, very critical. This corner coming up, a tight second gear left-hand corner that actually enters the banking. You can't see it at this point, but you're feeding the power in, anticipating it. And there it is, up ahead, you can see it, the start of the banking. Now you use the 800 horsepower. Get to the high line, get past the slower traffic, and down the back straight. At the halfway down the straight, here's the next, the chicane. Critical area, lots of traffic, lots of incidents at this point. And again, a critical exit from the chicane back onto this banking. Again, we're going back from the speeds of 80, 90, 100 miles an hour back to the 200 mile an hour area. Completes a very, very fast lap of the Daytona Speedway.
Back for the start of the 25th annual 24 Hours of Daytona after these messages.
Have just come to life on pit road at Daytona. We're moments away from the start of an American racing classic. The 24 hours of Daytona about to get underway, and it's my privilege to welcome a competitive ad libber and a pretty doggone good race driver. Owner driver of Porsche number 5, Bob Aiken. You saw him win here on TBS at Sebring about a year ago. Bob's going to help me run down four races within a race. The classes of competition here, Bob. Let's start with GTP Klaus Ludwig up front.
Well, the ultimate sports cars, Dave, for $500,000, 225 miles an hour, 800 horsepower, driven by the very best drivers.
And we move right on over to the newest class of competition. It's called Camel Lights, or GTL. There's a Fiero up front that doesn't look like a Fiero.
Well, these are the GTP's younger brothers, and it's a good training ground for people who want to move up, but still 170 miles an hour, about 350 horsepower.
A lot of people think the best race of the weekend is going to be over here in the GTO division. We've got an American-built Camaro on the pole.
Well, they look like production cars, but they're very sophisticated. 600 horsepower, 180 miles an hour, driven by a lot of the well-known drivers here.
Yeah, we got stock car stars up there. Those are stock cars on a road course. Last but not least, the GTU division with a lot of Mazdas.
Yeah, largely Mazdas and Porsches, basically production cars driven by a lot of weekend warriors, but they'll finish well in this race.
And they're looking for the front from the back right now. We're going to meet the guy who finished at the front last year. The defending champion in the 24 hours of Daytona is Al Hobert.
Well, we had expected Al Hobert to be in the role of a team manager and not a driver, but he's got his uniform on and it's your car, Al. I see you got the key here.
Yeah, Chip has a little problem finding his key sometime, and I'm not going to drive, but IMSA rules require anybody over the wall to have a uniform on, but of course if there's an emergency, I'd be right there.
Yeah, I imagine you will be. Okay, let's go to Chris Economaki for another report.
Well, I'm on my way down to the Columbia Crest Porsche pit. A.J. Foyt strapped in. We'll be back with Danny Sullivan a little later.
It's going to be very interesting to see who can lead early in this race, but the key is to lead at the end of the race. We're going to make it worth a little extra money to lead during the race. The True Value Hardware people have established the Leader of the Pack Awards for the 24 hours. $500 to the team that leads at 6 hours, at 12 hours, and at 18 hours. If you can lead all three and win the race, we'll throw in a $1,000 bonus and make it $2,500 in True Value Leader of the Pack Awards. The bottom line in racing is, be the leader of the pack. Now let's meet the starting lineup. Here's Ken Squire.
Taking a look at the 69-car field for today. In the front row, it is Jochen Mass driving in the car entered by Bruce Levin from out of the Great Northwest. The great Formula One driver will be teamed with Klaus Ludwig, another West German. And Bruce Levin himself will also take a turn at the wheel in this 24-hour contest. Starting beside him, a two-time winner of the 24 Hours of Daytona, that will be Wallach. Bob Wallach from France, and with him in that car is Darren Brasfield, the Trans Am star of a year ago, and Jim Busby. This is the car that came to third 1 year ago with Busby. We have an in-car camera in number 67. For row two, it's the Hendrick Corvette. It'll be Cyril Vandermeer teaming with Doc Bundy of Atlanta, Georgia. Also in row two is the Dyson car from Poughkeepsie, New York. Rob Dyson, part of him is Price Cobb and the great Australian driver, Vern Schupan. In row three, as the field now is moving out, Jim Adams is there with the Hotchkiss family. John, Senior and Junior Hotchkiss in car number 10. Then comes, in the sixth position, Chris Neifel, and he is teamed with Brian Redman and Elliot Forbes Robinson, truly one of America's great road racers. The Jaguar, which won here last November, Bob Tullius's car, will start in the seventh position. Hurley Haywood alongside in that machine as well as they get set for work. And John Morton joins the team, moving over from the BF Goodrich team. Going into the row four outside position, A.J. Foyt qualified there. He's won this race twice. This is his own car, and he is teamed with two other giants of Indianapolis. Three-time Indy winner, Al Unser Sr., and also in there is the 1985 winner, Danny Sullivan. Going to row five, and there you find the all-Italian team. Lorari is there. He's done so well at Le Mans. Sagala will be teamed with him. And also on that team is Bradichelli. Then in the 10th starting position, Derek Bell, two-time world champion, is teamed with Chip Robinson, Al Unser Jr. in the Hulbert car. Going to 11th position, there you find the Zach Speed Ford Mustang, David Hobbs, the key man there, young Whitney Gantz from Los Angeles teamed with him, and Moretti of Italy will be the third driver. In the 12th position, the car that won Sebring, Bob Aiken's car number 5, perhaps the fastest road racer in the world today, is teamed with him, Hans Stuck of West Germany and James Weaver of England. So those are the top 12, and now let's look at more of the field. Moving further down as we get this picture from our in-car camera, the 13th position is the Scott Pruitt-Pete Halsmer car, the Ford GTP. Then comes Don Bell and Klein. Back in the 15th position, Terry Labonte and Darrell Waltrip will be back in there, and we'll watch for them to run very well today. Today in 15th. The 16th position is Mike Rowe, Jerry Brasfield, Jim Bauer, as we just look down through these rows now of top candidates in the race. Lynn St. James' team will be starting in the 18th position with Bill Elliott and Tom Gloy. The 19th position today, Wally Dahlenbeck, Greg Pickett, Johnny Jones in GTO. Going back into the next row, we find in the 21st position, Jack Baldwin. You're looking out of the Morrison Cook car now, which our co-host will be working in, Bill Adam later today. That Jack Baldwin car, incidentally, is one that's expected to run very, very well before it's open. Back in the 25th position, as they come out of turn six and address the west end of the speedway, Ricky Rudd and Ron Manuel Fangio of Argentina will be starting in a Toyota Celica, which could really do a number before the day is over. The 26th position is Roger Mandeville. He's driving a new GTO car, the Mazda RX-7 with three rotors, up to 450 horsepower, 180. There you see it, that yellow and blue car on the outside of your frame. That is Mandeville, and that car could be a big surprise here in GTO today. All in all, 69 cars getting set for a start here as they go up onto the banking. Remember, it's a 3.5, 6-mile course, as Bill Adam pointed out earlier.
Well, right now, Ken, you can see the cars. They're busy trying to warm up these tires.
Hey, Bob.
Into the back straightaway, and you can see them warming up the tires, getting set to come to the chicane. How fast do you hit that chicane?
at a racing speed, it's going to be approaching 160 miles an hour down the back straight.
Here we are, just into the chicane. Hard right-hander, quick left. Get yourself back on the racetrack and rolling as fast as you can for the east end of the speedway. Here you are in the BF Goodrich car of Jim Busby. As we understand, it will be Wallach to start the driver assignment for the 24-hour contest. Remember, he teamed with A.J. Foyt in a controversial combination back in 1983. Wallach was not happy that year. Since then, they've kissed and made up. Well, they've made up. And we're getting set now for the go. The field motoring down through the 31-degree banking. East end of the speedway. That is the view from outside of the front row. Our second camera car is that Morrison Cook machine that is starting 64th. And I believe it is Bob McConnell who is the first driver up in that car. There you are in that Corvette back of the field. So we have one car up in the front, one car toward the rear. Porsche has won this race 15 times, 10 straight, going for an 11th. Mazda has won the GTU class for five straight years. And now the field moves down and gets set for the start.
Well, here's the moment right now, Ken. We're approaching the starting line. The boost level is right up. And look at this. We've got the start.
Down for the green. On the break into turn number one. Jumping out in front is the 11 car. That is Wallach. The field thunders 69 strong away for the start of 24 hours of competition live here on the Superstation.
This is really a critical spot right now. You've got to restrain yourself and not try and make that desperate stab and try and resist some of those emotions that make you want to go to the front. Be very careful with all this traffic.
So Bob Wallach has taken the quick lead. In the second spot is the number 67 car, the Busby car, being challenged as they go down that straightaway. There goes the Corvette moving up.
Yeah, I thought the Corvette had a good shot at him. You can really see the horsepower this American car puts out. But the Porsche came on there, was able to hold him off. Look at the Corvette closing up now under braking.
There you see the second place car, 67, right behind it. That is the Hendrick Corvette, number 52, Cyril Vandermeer at the controls. They won themselves a couple of IMSA races a year ago. And also closing up now is the all-Italian team in another half-million-dollar Porsche 962.
Now we'll watch the horsepower battle. This is starting down the back straight, and already they'll beat 150, 160 miles an hour right here, just getting into fifth gear, and they've still got all that time to stretch out.
Tremendous G-forces on those cars, and the way they are set up, there's not much room for air. It really is debilitating on a driver.
Oh, tremendous.
We were talking earlier with Bob Aiken down here in the Pit Communication Center about that Corvette as we watched the Porsche run out front, and you told me two interesting things. One had to do, Bob, with the tremendous speed of the Vette.
Well, yesterday in qualifying, the Vette hit 225 miles an hour on the start-finish straight.
That's a tremendous amount of speed. Right now, it's the Porsche out front that has the speed. The other issue about the Corvette is that they had to change a motor right before the race. They're a big question mark. Here's your leader.
And they lost a motor in qualifying in the Corvette. They might have been on the pole. Back to field comes at the end of lap number one. Porsche 962s are first and second. Chevrolet is third. Porsche 962s run fourth, fifth. Then a Jaguar runs in sixth. Car number 22 in trouble. One of the Roush cars, one of the Roush Fords. Number 22 that had originally been assigned for Deborah Dragon Company, and that one is limping. That one's hurt bad. There's number 22 coming on. It qualified well off the pace and is in trouble early. Now, on these cars, you can change just about anything. You can rebuild engines, tire down, as you see, left rear, dragging itself around and falling back quickly. Roush doesn't have a team here. They have a fleet.
They really do.
The
biggest problem Deborah faces here is not just changing the tire, but the problem of driving that car around the track on a damaged tire, and that can really hurt your suspension.
Second lap has been completed. It is the car that covers the most distance in the allotted time by 3:30 tomorrow afternoon that wins this 25th anniversary, the silver anniversary of this great event. And you don't have to be running at the finish to win it.
No, it's quite interesting. There was a race actually 1 year ago where Dan Gurney crossed the finish line on a starter motor, and just he had completed the greatest distance.
Now you see the Moretti car in trouble here for just a moment, trying to get wheeled around and restarted.
Oh, gee, that was almost contact right there with one of the Mustangs. He made a very, very dangerous U-turn right in front of him.
That was Sagala Lorari car, number three in trouble. Moretti, of course, is driving with David Hobbs and Whitney Gantz.
The area where he spun, Ken, that's entering the banking. You're trying to get that horsepower down. It's an area of track that always gets very slippery.
You're in with the Bob Wallach effort here at the present time. Porsche 962 into the infield portion of the course. Very short straightaway here, then the big horseshoe coming up to the yeses, working his way through the infield.
Just heading down into a 180-degree turn. Look at how tight he's keeping on the inside. And here he's feeding the car out. Look at right to the edge. A little bit of opposite lock there. He's getting the power down. Touch of wheel spin.
Second place car. And here's the number 22, one of the Roush cars at Ford Mustang in trouble, dragging itself around the course and trying to get back in to be serviced.
Agonizing. Oh, now here's the Morrison Cook car. They're in the pits right now getting a few things checked over, and this is a scheduled stop. They had problems early. Oh, it's not a schedule. Look at that right front wheel. I wonder if they made contact with Deborah Gregg's Mustang.
Now, this is the car which our co-announcer here, Bill Adam, is supposed to take over as soon as we go off the air at about 4:20.
That's right, and naturally, if I was in the car, I would never do anything like that,
Ken. Of course not. Of course not. Five-minute reports throughout the next 24 hours, and Motor Week Illustrated coming to you about 10:10 tonight, a special 40-minute version. Live from Daytona, the 24 hours of Daytona is underway, and at the present time, it is the Levin-Mass-Ludwig combination leading with Bob Wallach, the two-time winner, running in second, the Corvette, the Hendrick Corvette, Cyril Mandeverver at the wheel in third, and running fourth at the present time is the Rob Dyson team out of Poughkeepsie, New York, with Price Cobb currently at the controls, Vern Schupan standing by. There you see the leader wheeling through traffic as the Morrison Cook Corvette comes back on the track.
This gives you a good idea just exactly what it's like. He's entering out pit lane here, and this is the view we get. That big high scoop that's necessary for fuel injection really does disturb your view. You don't get that crystal clear view like you would have on a streetcar, and it just adds to the problems. Just exiting here, we're still not onto the track. We'll be rejoining right about here. Now we're back on the race line, and you've got to watch your mirrors. You've got to watch for traffic coming up the inside of you. You're accelerating from zero, getting back up to race speed, and you've got to watch that inside.
With the hood cocked up, there's really not much vision out of that car.
No, it's very, very poor. It can be a problem at night, particularly, too, when you're looking for an apex of a corner.
And up on the banking, almost none. The Morrison Cook car comes back on the track as Porsche 962s run first and second here in the early moments of the 24 hours of Daytona. The fifth lap on the 3.56-mile road course at the Daytona International Speedway. You are watching Francis Bob Wallach, two-time winner of this event, out in front at over 180 miles per hour. Running in second, it is still the Busby car, and in third, the Chevrolet Corvette.
No, you just made a mistake that I've been making all weekend long, that Wallach is no longer in that car. That's now Klaus Ludwig in that.
Klaus Ludwig in it, and in the second place car is the Bob Wallach.
You have it there.
That's Bob Wallach, two-time winner of the event. Let's go to Dave Despain on pit road.
I find that a fascinating switch, that those guys just traded one car for the other. They went in exactly the opposite car a year ago. We're here with the owner driver of one of the cars in the race, Bob Aiken. Tell me a little about early strategy. Number one, are you surprised to see the Levin guys go to the front and this third place Corvette? You mentioned something about their strategy.
Well, Levin's car doing well is not a surprise, but I really would have expected the Corvette to have made a move for the lead by this time.
Why?
Well, to be honest, I don't think he can go the distance, and I really think he ought to make his move while he's still got an engine in the car.
And while he's still on television.
That's
right.
Right.
Wallach's team still now running in that second spot as we watch the battle for the lead here. We're going to follow this battle, all the battles of this race, throughout the 24 hours. Remember now, we have hourly updates for you live from Daytona all night long. Special edition of Motor Week, a 40-minute edition tonight at 10:10. So stay with us for all the action of this 24 hours of Daytona as we watch Klaus Ludwig run up front.
The number 86 car now maintaining about a 3.5-second advantage over Bob Wallach in the second position. Let's go to Jerry Garrett on pit road.
Well, we were down here in the pits of the Jack Roush team, and one of the contenders, the GTO Mustang, number 22, with Deborah Gregg at the wheel, came in here with a couple of flat tires. Now, we thought that there might be some underbody damage, but they changed the tires, checked it out. No problems. She's back out there. She'll be back in contention over another hour or two, I would think.
Do you think there's any possibility that the Panzer Division, the Porsches, can be stopped in this 24 hours by those Fords? They've come in here with a normally aspirated and a fuel-injected car. They haven't gone with turbos in an effort to just get endurance into the Fords.
Well, Jack Roush, he's done a very, very interesting thing and really has provided a product that a lot of people think can beat the Porsches. He's taken the GTO motor, which really in the last couple of seasons has proven to be almost indestructible, and put it in probably the most advanced chassis built today, the Probe. So the combination looks awfully good, Ken.
Well, there you see the leader in GTO. That is Terry Labonte, Darrell Waltrip, Greg Pickett, and Greg Pickett had the starting assignment in that car. Imagine Labonte and Waltrip, who will be enemies here in 2 weeks, on the same team. And in the GTO class, they're in first right now. Lynn St. James, Tom Gloy, and Elliott are running second in a Mustang, that Camaro. And then it is the Ted Booty car, number 74. Toronado running in third. And moving up is Baldwin, Jack Baldwin, and Epi Wietzes in another Camaro running fourth. But there you see the leader in the GTO class.
Great looking car, too. That's one of the beautiful protofab Camaros that we're watching last year. Just absolutely clean house and win the Trans Am Championship. Tremendous.
Charlie Selleck's team. Now we have among the leaders, number seven now pitting. The David Hobbs car has come on pit road.
And I hope we haven't jinxed them. Just when we talk about these cars being such strong packages, all of a sudden one makes an appearance.
Fueling the automobile.
They're telling him to clean the windshield. That's what he's signaling for there at the front. Trying to get somebody out there. There he comes.
And we have another car running very slowly.
That's car number 83. That's a GTO entry. It's a Firebird. Reisman, Hebert, Gaffney, and Stone in that car.
Looks like a modified stock car you might find at Stafford Springs, Connecticut.
It actually sounded like it, too. A similar type of exhaust system and differential on it, Ken. You're very familiar with those.
Number 83 slowing down to the bottom of the banking, the Gaffney car coming in. In the GTU class right now, Amos Johnson with a Mazda RX-7 is up in front. Sean and Leisure in that combination for the Mazda RX-7 team in first, and in the Camel Light Series, it is Earl, Bell, and Klein. Number 01, the Fiero, is up in front. Bob Earl's car in the second position is the second Fiero. That is the Durst Brockman Abel car, second in GTO, with Greg Hobbs currently being shown, David Hobbs' son, making his first appearance in America, 24 years old, maintaining a BMW in that third position.
Talking of David Hobbs, Ken, just got a report that Hobbs actually had pitted 4 oil in the windshield. That was the problem. So the reliability of the car was not in question. It was just a vision problem. You can see here, here's an excellent shot of the in-car camera in the BF Goodrich Porsche. The windshield is nice and clean right now, but it won't be very long before it really gets streaked with oil and you get rubber thrown up. And in the late afternoon sun, we saw just a moment ago as the Bayside Porsche came down the front straight, you get a great view of the driver sitting in there because the sun is straight in your face. That combination of the sun on an oily windshield makes it almost impossible to look out of.
You are a great and world-class driver, and in this race you have everything from amateur night at the Rialto to people like A.J. Foyt, great road racers. It must be extremely difficult to pick your way to a 70-car field out here.
It can be, because this track presents so many different problems that most people don't see but once a year. With going into darkness, you get a sun that's very, very low in the horizon. You get a lot of the lower class drivers in the GTU cars really not concentrating on what's behind them.
Let's go to Chris Economaki.
Danny Sullivan, the Indianapolis 500 winner 2 years ago, sharing the car with A.J. Foyt and Al Unser. A.J.'s out there. Now, Danny, how tough is watching and waiting?
Well, the beginning is pretty tough because you're anxious, you're excited, you'd like to be out there, you see everybody racing. After the first stint, I don't do a whole lot of watching unless we've got a problem or it was a real close race. But basically, you just try to relax between stints and store up as much energy as you can. It's going to be a long night.
What about Danny at Indianapolis? It's foot to the floor all the way around, all the way from green to checker. Here it's discipline. How tough is it to baby a car and not let yourself race?
Well, what you have to do is really, as you say, be disciplined, because we want to run a certain pace and have no problems, and that's the only way to win here. And so you just have to sit tight and hold your breath, and sometimes when you want to pass somebody and you know you shouldn't, because the damage may take you a half an hour to fix it if you take that extra chance. Here it's just a good thing to be slow.
Who goes in the car after AJ, Sue? You or Al?
No, Al'll do the second stint, and then I'll do a double stint when the sun starts to go down, because it doesn't seem to affect my eyes as much as everybody else. So I'm going to start about 6 o'clock and go for about 3 hours.
Well, good luck, Danny. Thank you.
Thank you.
Back to you, Kevin.
There's the leader, Bob Olick out in front, and closing is the Chevrolet Corvette. It is moving in and making a stab at going for first place here in the first hour of our live coverage on the superstation of the 24 Hours of Daytona. Bob Olick of France maintaining a stout run here in the third position. Chevrolet is in second, and it is Porsche in the lead. Hestwig, who we saw last year driving the Ford, now in the Bruce Levin car, out in front. But not by much, as the Hendrick Corvette is right here in second place and trying to close ground as they come through the fourth turn of the Super Speedway. It's turn 9 of the 3.5-mile road course here at Daytona. There's that Corvette, winner a couple of times last year and on the pole forever.
Oh, definitely the fastest car that has ever been to Daytona. It just has incredible amounts of horsepower. It's a very, very good chassis, great aerodynamics, superb racing car, and he really is making a challenge right now.
2.5 seconds between this car, number 86, the leader in the event, Klaus Ludwig at the controls, and the Corvette, the Hendrick car with Cyril Vandermeer in the second position. Here he comes now, and you get a feeling for that interval between first and second place.
Beautiful car.
Endurance, reliability, perseverance. The story here as we follow it live on the Superstation. Greatest sports car race in the Western Hemisphere, now celebrating its 25th year. And there you see that Corvette darting around some slower automobiles as it tries to collect that leader. Number 86 now moving back on the Super Speedway.
Well, it's very interesting right now. As we talked about, that it takes a special type of racing psychology to win a 24-hour race, and that's one where you back off. You run at an 80, 90% capability, and you try not to stress the car. Now, what they're doing right now is running at a pace that's about 10 seconds off their qualifying pace, and this is very, very easy on these cars.
Let's go to Chris Economak.
I'm in the Chevrolet Corvette pit with crew chief Ken House. Ken, everyone expected Vandermeer to make a run for the lead. That's not happened. Is there any reason why?
Well, we've had a lot of trouble in practice. And we've had to change the engine just before the race started. We had to gamble on the boost setting. And it's a little lower than what we were hoping for, but we're going to leave it there. And, well, we're in the lead, so I guess that answers your question.
Oh, there you go, right there. Well, that's a great moment. Are you confident of finishing?
Well, I'd like to be, but we're really not sure. We've never done anything like this before. We're trying. We'll just keep our fingers crossed. And
well, good luck to you. Thank you very much. There you have this look on his face. And right in front of us, his car took the lead. Back to you, Ken.
And there's one of the Fords in trouble. That's the number 4 car, which had been assigned to Scott Pruitt and Pete Halsmer. And that car is off the course. That is the Roush Ford that has been entered, and there is problems for Scott Pruitt, Trans Am star of a year ago. Now, we have a new leader in the race. The Chevrolet has gone out in front. You saw it as it came down, scurrying into the turn number 1 area. As 86 got caught up in some back markers, the 52 car took a shot at the lead. You're now in third place, looking at the view of first and second as Bob Wollick sees it in car number 67, the Jim Busby car. Here's the Morrison Cook car further back in the field, fighting its way through and hoping to stay in here long enough till things get sorted out and they get Bill Adam at the control.
This very interesting comparison we've just had. There were the two cars going over the same piece of track, and just look at the different visibilities that the drivers get. The Porsche has absolutely clear visibility. You can see what seems like 3 feet in front of the car. There's the Porsche again. Now, here's a great example. Look at this visibility. You can pick out the apex exactly where you want to put the car.
Now we're back inside the Busby car, now back to the Morrison Cook car to give you that perspective.
And again, that huge scoop out front there over top of the fuel injection just obscures so much of your view. You have to be very careful, and you just saw a car dart up the outside of the track by the wall. So careful out here.
The battle for the lead as we're watching car number 4 for just a moment. That was one of the cars that Ford had such great hopes for, and there's that continuing effort being made by the Chevrolet Corvette. The Hendrick car, Cyril Vandermeer leading, and right behind him is the 86.
That's a really interesting battle right now because you like to put your car out front. Chevrolet will be very happy right now. Their car is being shown national across North America, and yet, do you want to stress that car? Poor Scott's maybe overstressed his car a little too much.
Scott Pruitt clambering out of car number 4. That looks like it is a serious problem. Not in any hurry there.
No, he appears to be trying to change the black boxes on the electronic ignition system. He's leaning back with one hand doing that and putting the other hand forward to try and hit the starter button.
And they're probably telling him on the radio about those black boxes. Remember, they did that with Derek Bell a couple of years. And
yeah, that's right. He will be in contact.
A remote explanation. Mm-hmm. Here's your leader another time. Cyril Vandermeer out in front.
See that little puff of flame there just when he shifts. difference. That's just the gas and the turbochargers. Nothing wrong with the car.
And right behind him comes Klaus Ludwig in the 86. There's Ludwig within 1 second. Let's go to Dave Despain.
Well, in the STP Pit Communication Center with Bob Aiken, the prophet, you called it. The Corvette goes to the front. Couple of questions here. We've got the Americans up and challenging. You got the Corvette and the Ford that the guys up in the booth think is such a challenger. There's all this brand loyalty in this form of racing, just like stock car racing. Can the Corvette finish? Can the Fords beat the Porsches? I ask you, a Porsche owner driver.
Well, really, Dave, I'd love to see an American car win the race, but Porsche's won it so many years, and they're so reliable and so well worked out. I think it would be the eighth wonder of the world, if anything, but a Porsche won this race.
Dave Cowart has trouble on pit road. You told me you thought Klaus Ludwig in that Porsche might back off a little bit after 10 laps. Would that perhaps be why the Corvette was able to take the lead, and why would Ludwig want to slow down at this point?
Well, there's a pace that you set in the first couple of laps just to kind of get clear of traffic and get sorted out and sort of see how the car is handling. But then you could just sort of notch back up to your race pace. And if they notch back and the Chevy maintained an earlier pace, the Chevy would pass him.
And that is exactly what's happened. There you see the battle, and that is Van der Merwe with the lead in the Corvette. And just about 10 to 12 car lengths back is Klaus Ludwig, now running second in the Porsche. And you heard it called right here. He called the first move right when the Corvette made the pass. And now Bob Aiken says it'll be the eighth wonder of the world if anybody beats Porsches here in Daytona. Ken?
Bob Aiken's car is currently running in seventh position. Hans Stuck is at the controls. Here we are, back up on the west end of the speedway, and it is a race for first place. At Chevrolet Corvette is out in front, but only by eight car lengths, and here comes Klaus Ludwig as they head into the back straightaway.
Well, Ludwig's got the advantage of a draft. Here's stock car racing, and look at this. Shades of Cale Yarborough. Going down towards the chicane, they're under braking. He flashes a headlight. Sarrell was telling somebody, look out, I'm coming through. You're going to see a car in the picture very soon. Sarrell wants to warn them.
Making room for those faster cars by flashing their lights to lap cars.
Anything that'll get someone's attention, let you get by a little bit more safely.
We'll be back with more live coverage of the 24 hours of Daytona in a moment. 15th lap, and this car is now in second place, number 52. The Levin car, Klaus Ludwig, has gone into first place just a lap back, and let's take a look at how it happened.
Going on to the banking, Sarrell couldn't get a good strong run to use all that horsepower, and look at this. The Porsche appears to have more power simply because he was able to get on the gas earlier. But watch this battle down the back straight, side by side, and look, he passes, and what happens? Sarrell gives him the old headlight.
And as we come back to live action with you once again, I think that the number 52 car has some kind of an electrical problem. Those lights that came on and we thought they were signaling for back markers to move over, they're coming on every time he seems to tap the brakes.
It could be even just a case of backing off the gas. There may be a wire that's a little bit loose and it can flop backwards and forwards.
Klaus Ludwig in the lead. Let's take a moment now to update ourselves and find out about other motorsports that are happening and go to the Motor Week GM Goodwrench Race Report. And standing by is Bob Barsha.
Thanks, Ken. Hello, everyone. It's appropriate that season opening events highlight our first GM Goodwrench Motor Week Illustrated Racing Update of the year. At Pomona, California, sunny skies are shining on the first big drag race of the year, the NHRA Winter Nationals. They're in first round eliminations at this hour. World champs Bob Glidden in Pro Stock and Kenny Bernstein in the funny cars are the top qualifiers in class. Hank Endridge, though, is the surprise leader in Top Fuel. He's doing better than 264 miles an hour, and he's the leader there. At Parker, Arizona, early this morning, Mark McMillan's buggy led a record field off the line in the Parker 400. That's the first big off-road event of the year. But after the first leg in California, it's the Toyota truck of Ivan Stewart, who's the Ford-wheeled leader by about 2.5 minutes. This is also one of the biggest snowmobile weekends of the season. At La Crosse, Wisconsin, the Formula One event, world champion Chuck Decker is the top qualifier for tomorrow's featured final. Meanwhile, Tim Bender leads the three-day St. Paul Winter Carnival for snowmobiles. And at a great event going on right now, right on Canadian border, Minnesota Norm Nakanus leads the 500-mile Amsoil International Race. That's from Thunder Bay, Canada, to Minneapolis, Minnesota, on snowmobiles in sub-freezing temperatures. We'll have final results on these events and a whole lot more in our next edition of the GM Goodwrench Motor Week Illustrated Racing Update.
Thank you, Bob Barsha. In the 60s here, going down to the 40s tonight, high 70s tomorrow. The forecast for this 24-hour endurance contest, largest sports car race in the Western Hemisphere. Ooh. And the Chevrolet goes completely off the course as Sarrell Van der Merwe tries to wind in the Levin number 86, being driven by West Germany's Klaus Ludwig. France versus Germany.
A
Germany versus the United States as far as first and second are concerned here. Boy, Chevrolet Corvette closing up.
A major mistake on Serrell's part there, and he really controlled it so well that it didn't look that difficult, but it could have been absolutely disaster. He's at 130 miles an hour at that point, and it just looked like nothing to him.
Back they come directly below us. Everybody watching those clocks to check the interval. Running back in third position is the BF Goodrich car. Then in fourth is A.J. Foyt. Unser Sr. and Danny Sullivan. The Jaguar is in fifth. Bob Tullius' car in sixth is the Poughkeepsie, New York team. That's Dyson Cobb and Schupan of Australia. Into seventh moves the Bob Aiken Porsche 962. Hans Stuck currently driving. And Chris Neifel, just back from that series down in New Zealand and Australia with Brian Redman and Elliot Forbes Robinson, is running in eighth in a 962. The car that won it last year is in ninth position. Derek Bell, Al Unser Jr., and Chip Robinson. There you see the second place car trying to gather in the leader another time. Let's go to Chris Economaki.
I'm with Walter Gerber, the crew chief for Klaus Ludwig. Klaus had said at the outset he's going to take it easy and be very disciplined. He's out there racing the wheels off the car. Is that an order from the pits, Walter?
No, he's not really racing. We set ourselves a time between 45 and 47, and that's what he's doing. And that's why sometimes they catch up, sometimes he's ahead. So he's on his pace, the pace we set.
How steady is he?
Very steady.
Okay, very steady, back and forth, in and out of the lead for Klaus Ludwig. Back to you, Ken.
Here's Ludwig in first, and right behind him comes the Corvette, the American-made Corvette in second place. It's a power plant from the United States for sure.
That's
a lot
right.
of that car coming from Great Britain. And here's Double Zero in trouble and off the course at the present time. Waiting for some assistance is Charles Slater out of Fort Lauderdale, Florida. The S-squared engineering. So I get T-squared the way it's standing there now.
He's pulled off quite a way off the track, so it looks like it's a fairly major problem to the car.
Now across the board in GTO, Labonte, Waltrip, Pickett are leading there. And in GTU class, it is currently car number 54, a Porsche 911 that is out in front. That is the Dieter Quest car. And then in the Camel Light Series, Earl Bell and Klein. They have their Pontiac Fiero, Bob Earl's team, right up in front. You're back with the leader. Now you're riding with the in-car camera that is in the BF Goodrich car in third position.
You can see how the light has changed already. This is just going through turn one here. Look at that light reflecting off the dashboard. Here is the perfect area as we're going away from the sun. You've got great visibility and everything is wonderful as you approach this 180, but watch how it changes.
Is it mandatory to run with the windshield wipers when you know there's going to be no rain?
No, down here there's been so many incidents where they've said weather's going to be perfect and lo and behold, an absolute downpour hits.
Now there's the Morrison Cook car.
Looks like downtown Miami. There's everybody streaming around.
Okay, you excited about getting out there?
Huh? Yeah, I'm looking forward to it, Ken.
Is it hard to run in a car like that rather than one that's a tad quicker?
Well, my home away from home is the Bayside car, which is leading the race right now, and of course I would like to be in that, but I'm very happy to be in this Morrison Cook Corvette. It's a good car, and it looks like it stands quite a realistic chance of a GTO win.
One of the things I love about racing in general, and especially about endurance racing, is the difference in the race you hear about and the race that you see on the racetrack. Everybody says, no, we're just running a pace, we're just taking it easy, we're saving the cars. They're out there bouncing off the walls and scrambling for the lead like it was the last lap. What's going on here, Bob Aiken? Are they racing or are they not?
Well, you know, both Klaus and Sarl now know each other's race pace. You know, if Klaus lets up just a little bit, then Sarl goes by and says, you see, I told you, Klaus, don't you dare slow up.
Well, what about the curb bouncing?
Well, that's not supposed to be. You don't go around bouncing off curbs in a 24-hour race and expect to have any suspension left at the end of the day.
Which leads me to think they're out there getting it on pretty good. Your guy, Hans Stuck, back in fifth place, not showing us much yet. What's going on there?
Well, he's doing what he was told to do. We're out there running the pace that we set the day before yesterday, really, and we don't expect to be anywhere near the lead for another hour or so.
And the guy who tells Hans Stuck what to do in this case, Hans Stuck, a world champion, is his car owner and my colleague, Bob Aiken, who's going to be getting into that car a little later on. There is your leader. It is still Ludwig for the moment. The Corvette is caught in that traffic jam behind him, and it looks like a pretty doggone good race up front to me, Ken. We're going to follow this lead as we move through the final laps here of our coverage and be back with more updates throughout the night at the 24 Hours of Daytona.
24 hours of Daytona here on the Superstation, and back in the pack, a great battle for fourth, fifth, and sixth position. The number 44 Jaguar that won here last November. The only 12-cylinder car in the field. That is the Bob Tullius machine. They brought one Jaguar here. It is currently being shown in fifth. Directly in front of it is A.J. Foyt's car number one, and there you see that one. The California Crest car running in fourth, and behind it is the Price Cobb-driven, Dyson-owned 962. They're running in six. Now there you see number one, then 44, that's the Jaguar, and then number 16 in the sixth position, Dyson, Cobb, and Chupin. Good battle, and that one keeps accordion as they come around the track. Here you see A.J. Foyt, who is teamed the four-time winner with a three-time winner, the Unsers. They used to be like the Hatfields and the Coys. And now we have Unser, Foyt, and Danny Sullivan. Eight Indianapolis wins among them. All battling here to win this 24 hours of Daytona in this beautiful car, which A.J. Foyt has entered. Right behind him comes the Jaguar, number 44, Bob Tullius and company, Hurley Haywood teaming with him today, and John Morton, who for my money is as good as they get. And then right behind the 44, here comes Price Cobb, the Dyson car, won a couple of times and crashed severely a few times last year.
May have a real good shot at a pass coming up here. Price is out on the outside of the Jaguar, just trying to fill up Bob's mirrors right now. Maybe rattle him a tiny little bit, make him make a mistake, and let him get past easily.
Battle for fifth position. Price Cobb closes in on Bob Tullius.
This is great fun. Right now what these guys are doing are running a very quiet pace. They're not extending either themselves or the car, but because they have somebody to play with, they're able to keep their attention very, very sharp.
Fourth, fifth, and sixth positions here. And now you see the Jaguar making a move. It's the Jaguar of Tullius going around A.J. Foyt, and the Jag picks up a spot. Bob Tullius goes into fourth. A.J. Foyt falling to fifth. Price Cobb now trying to make a move on A.J.
Great example there of instant torque and horsepower. The Jaguar is a naturally aspirated motor. That is, it's fuel injected, whereas the Porsches are turbocharged. If you don't get on the gas pedal soon enough, you lose the horsepower. You don't get it immediately, and that's exactly what happened.
And also in that mix-up is Neifel, Redmond, and Robinson, the car that's been in seventh position. They're in there and ready to challenge. Here comes A.J.
Now, there's a great shot right there, Ken. That showed that A.J.'s car is running more boost. He has his turbocharger turned up a little bit higher than the Porsche he just passed, but he's going to pay a penalty with poor fuel mileage. He'll have to pit first.
Heavy traffic, and A.J. got run off the course there. Oh. A.J. went all the way out on a lap car, and he really had to make a great maneuver, or else he would have gone right clean through the chicane. As you see, the Jaguar came through, and the Jaguar is back to fourth. Coming with him is the number 16 car. A.J. falls to six.
Yeah, after A.J. had shown that horsepower in the back straight, because he'd had to get off the gas and was really forced wide going in, Price Cobb was able to get a pretty good lead and is now back on Tullius' tail.
So the battle is for fourth. Now the challenger for the fourth position, which is held by Tullius in the number 44 Jaguar. Oh. Here it comes at turn one, up on the outside, Price Cobb. Heavy braking, yes. And he's going to take the spot.
Sensational pass. Like, that's a very risky maneuver for a race like this. But Price really felt that he had to get by the Jag. I wouldn't be surprised to see him pull out a lead now. He has seen something, or perhaps he's getting his windshield affected by the Jag exhaust.
So that seems to settle that for a moment, as Price Cobb made an incredible maneuver on Bob Tullius and takes over in fourth position. But it's a long way to 3:30 tomorrow. There are nine Porsches in today's race, and the German factory has come up with a unique way to support this massive effort. Chris Economaki took a look around the truck the competitors lovingly call the Porsche store.
Remember the old 15-cent racing program and 25-cent hot dog? Well, concession item prices at racetrack have gone up, just as they have everywhere else. Today's racing program is $5, and the lonely hot dog is $2.50. There are concession stands of every size, shape, and description on the grounds, but the most costly items are to be found here at the Porsche Motorsport Parts Truck. 48 feet long, hospital clean, it is stocked with 30,000 parts. The computerized inventory system reveals enough parts to build two complete $380,000 racing cars. Let's take a look at what things cost here. This locked rear end differential is a steal at $4,033. The titanium connecting rod goes for $730, and you need six. Prices are pegged to the German mark, so vary daily. Think about this for a moment. There are a dozen Porsches or so in the 24 hours, but a waiting line for parts once the race is half over is not unusual. Contestants have to leave signed but blank checks here before they take anything away. And we're told that if this truck doesn't do $100,000 worth of business by the time the checkered flag waves, it's been a slow weekend.
Live coverage of the 24 hours of Daytona continuing, and the battle is still enjoined right here. A.J. Foyt just tried to make a move on the Jaguar, and it looked like Tullius put him right to the wall.
Oh, this is really just a tremendous battle right now. I'm surprised at the intensity that's going on here. Foyt tried a high pass, much the same as what Price Cobb did a few laps ago, and Tullius just did not let him by.
And that 44 car is the Tullius car. The green and white car directly behind him is A.J. Foyt. Foyt is relegated to sixth position, and you get Foyt's blood temperature up a little here, and you're going to see some racing. He may have come on in years, but he still loves to win, and you put a block on him, and he'll remember it.
He's an incredible man. Anything he touches, AJ can win it.
Well, he's had, you know, he won the Daytona 500 back in 72, and he keeps coming back and trying again and again. And this year, they say, he's got a pretty good car coming in here for the 500 in 2 weeks. Now, here he is, closing up on that Jaguar another time. 44 is the old veteran, Bob Tullius, who first won here at Daytona back in 1965 in a Dodge. Here he is, carrying the Jaguar colors, number 44. Directly in front is Price Cobb in the Dyson, number 16. Beautiful machine, well turned out. Tullius trying to close in. Foyt about 10 car lengths back, and Tullius looks like he wants to make a run here.
Again, that V12 Jaguar has such great immediate torque. And look at this. He's pulling to the inside, but here's a slower car. All right, left, right. Well, let's try up the middle here, and you thread it. But look at Foyt.
Right
outside.
Right beneath us at 180 miles. That's right where Foyt was in trouble the last time. This time he is able to make it through, and he challenges Dyson on the outside. Right where Tullius.
These guys are treating this not like a 24, but this is more like a 24-minute race. They're hard at it.
Right where Tullius nearly put Foyt in the Tullius. He's on the last lap on the high side. AJ came right back and made his pass there. And he closes in on the Rob Dyson car. Price Cobb at the controls.
Well, while these fellas are out here playing, they're running at 117 mile an hour average. Now, that's down to 25 miles an hour, perhaps, at the hairpin, but they're flying.
Incredible action here in the early going of the 24 hours of Daytona.
We're going to be wrapping up this first hour of coverage, but we'll be right back in just 30 minutes as we continue our coverage back at 4:50 Eastern Time. A tremendous competition continuing throughout the field. And just for the record, Bob Aiken says the Jaguar, you're watching right there, is the best bet to pull off the eighth wonder of the world and beat the Jaguars. We'll be back in 30 minutes.
Season. I'm Dave Despain. I'll also have a look back at the 24 hours of Daytona. The Parker 400 kicks off the off-road campaign, and from Anaheim, California, it's Supercross action. For all the motorsports, catch Motorweek Illustrated tonight at 10:30 Eastern Time on Superstation WTBS.
One hour and 15 minutes into WTBS live coverage of the silver anniversary, 24 hours of Daytona. Ken Squire with you at Daytona International Speedway. And Porsches have the top three positions, now led by Jochen Mass, who has replaced Klaus Ludwig in car number 86. They did that on the 35th lap of competition. There have been no major developments in the race other than these pit stops. There you see the Dan Gurney Toyota Celica being lapped by number 86, the Bruce Levin car. For a moment, we had Jaguar up as high as second place. Now, after the pit stops, that Jag is running in fifth position. Further back in the field, the Cyril Vandermeer car had dropped to eighth. It has come back into third after the pit stops. We had an opportunity by Chris Economaki to interview a very confident Klaus Ludwig after he made that driver change the lead car.
Klaus, you looked hot and overheated. Was it very difficult the first stint?
No, I'm not overheated at all. It's just pretty warm, and so you start to sweat. But it was a nice pace, easy pace, no yellow.
You had a nice dice there with the Corvette. Enjoy that?
I think we are going, as I said, for the 24 hours. The Corvette may be only doing 2 or 3 hours, so I took it easy. But I think I was faster on the turns, and he was a little bit faster on the straightaway.
Okay, thanks and good luck.
More from the Daytona Speedway in a moment.
TBS Sports' continuing live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona is brought to you by Dodge, setting new standards of performance. And by B.F. Goodrich TA Radials. TA Radials, tested tough to make your car perform.
The car that everyone is chasing is this number 86, now being driven by West Germany's Jochen Mass. But the car everyone is talking about is the Hendrick Corvette, car number 52, which has come all the way to second place, then made a pit stop for a driver change. We followed that action of this car number 52 as it's fought its way up toward the top, averaging some 119 miles per hour. And as to how things are going in that car, here's what the driver said as he stepped out after that pit stop.
I'm with Doc Bundy, Sal Vandenberg's co-driver. Sal came in very slowly and early. You know what the trouble was, Doc?
Yeah, we just ran out of fuel. See, we haven't been in a situation where we could do a lot of practice and check a fuel mileage run. So we had to run till it ran out, switch on the reserve and come in. And it just had trouble picking up the fuel in reserve.
That doesn't hurt the engine, huh?
No, we're fine.
Okay, I can tell by your smile, Doc. Good luck to you.
The Corvette is running third, averaging 119 miles per hour, chasing two Porsches. More from Daytona following these words.
James, in the GTO class, Bill Elliott and Tom Gloy are making you drive last, third shift. I want to know why.
Well, they're going to have to make a brake pad change, so we're going to give a little more time for the stop because I'm the short one and got to get my insert in.
Want to see you on Motor Week tonight at 10:10. Quickly, the leaders, Moss in the GTP division, Camel Light, Greg Hobbs, David's kid in a BMW. Over here, we've got the stock car guys leading GTO. Oberland, Durkheimer, and Ost, not a law firm, the leaders at GTU. We'll be back at 5:35. Stay tuned for Roland Martin and Fishing.
One update with them.
TBS Sports continuing live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona is brought to you by Budweiser, the genuine article. Beechwood aged for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. And by Dodge, setting new standards of performance.
1 hour, 51 minutes into the 24 Hours of Daytona, about 30 minutes prior to sundown, and we are under our first caution period of the day. It's been brought out, the Gentilozzi booty car, an Oldsmobile, has gone off course. They want to remove it before they continue. It had been running fourth in GTO until that moment. At the present time, three Porsche 962s have the front three spot, led by the Bruce Levin car, which is dominated. That's followed by Jim Busby's BF Goodrich machine, and then A.J. Foyt, Danny Sullivan, and Unser. The first of the un-Jaguar class goes to the Jaguar. The Bob Tullius car with Hurley Haywood currently at the keyboard is in fourth position, and in fifth is the Chevrolet of Vandenberg and Bundy. Now there's the leader in the pits. This is under caution, and it is a full course caution that is taking place at this time. For this car number 52 that we've been talking about, the Chevrolet Corvette has already had to pit twice. It's getting shorter range on its mileage out here, and the second pit stop was just moments ago, or it would have been up in the top five. You're watching the leader at the present time, number 86. That car is the Jochen Mass machine at the present time. And there is car number 52 coming in moments ago for its driver change. Cyril Vandenberg stepping out and Doc Mundy taking over in that car. Again, that Corvette is running well, but the analysts say it may not run much past dark. Won't it be a surprise if it's round tomorrow at 3:30? Some cars are having more difficulties than others here, and they're rather unusual problems. Here's that story.
Meet Elliot Forbes Robinson, Brian Redmond, and Chris Neifel, the Primus Motorsport team, otherwise known as Team Trouble. Former world champion Redmond has brought a barely mended broken arm to the 24 Hours, while as a result of stuffing his 6'6" body into race cars built for six-footers, Neifel has a vision problem.
Yeah, I'm looking right through the very top 2 or 3 inches is where I look out of the windshield. And it really is very good vision, you know, when the day's clear and everything. But I think if we get some bad weather and rain, the defroster on the windshield doesn't go up that high and the windshield wiper doesn't go that high. So it's a potential problem.
Well, at least we know one member of the team can carry the load. Right, Elliot? Elliot?
I don't think there'll be a problem with it. It's been done before where we've had to drive a lot of hours. And I think that their health will be okay, though. I'm looking to have them pull normal shifts.
But I'm somewhat questionable as far as physically being able to go for that long, but I don't foresee any problem. Brian's arm, obviously, is a potential problem. And EFR's age is just out of control, so I don't know what we're going to do.
That team eighth, more in a moment. Been completed, and there you see the current standings as we're under a full course caution and remaining so at this hour. A Jochen Mass team out in front. Coming up next, fishing with Orlando Wilson. Next update at 6 o'clock Eastern.
CBS Sports continuing live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona is brought to you by Dodge, setting new standards of performance.
Coming up on sunset in a matter of moments here at the Daytona International Speedway, the only placid setting here, beautiful Lake Lloyd, right in the very heart of the infield. Around it at over 180 miles per hour in the back straightaway, it's the car of Bruce Levin that continues to run out in front here. At the present time, there are 4 cars running in the lead lap. We're 2 hours and 26 minutes deep into the event, and it is the Bruce Levin car that is running in first place. In the second position currently, it is the B.F. Goodrich car, the Jim Busby machine. Maintaining third is the Cyril Vandemerver, Doc Bundy Corvette. They've done an incredible job staying up there, although they're making more pit stops than others. And in fourth is last year's winner, Derek Bell and company, the Al Hulbert car. Fifth is A.J. Foyt currently. Just coming into darkness, and then the long ride begins. Al Unser Jr. has said, by morning, even your toes are tired in this grueling round-the-clock test. Twice round-the-clock, there you see the leader in the back straightaway at better than 180 miles per hour. Coming up shortly, Chris Economaki will be talking to one of the lead Ford drivers, David Hobbs, and we'll have that for you right after these messages. Let's go to the STP Pit Center, and there's Chris Economaki and David Hobbs.
Well, David, you must have mixed emotions now. Your car's in 10th place, 4 laps down, but I see your son Greg in his first big race has moved to second in the lights category. Has he ever raced at night, David?
No, he's never raced at night before. He's never raced here at Daytona before, and he's never raced at these sort of speeds before, so obviously he's a bit nervous, and so am I. And he didn't race in the daylight today, so the first time he drives the car in the race is going to be tonight, by which time it'll be fully dark.
What about the cars and the headlights? Do they show you enough in your category and in his category?
Not really. The trouble with the banking, of course, is the light shines right into the bank, so you can't see around the banking at all. Then on the back straightaway, where you really need some penetration, the lights can never go quite as fast as these cars.
Let's take a look at the standings of the other categories, David, if you will.
Okay, in the GTU, it's a Mazda show at the moment. Johnson Shaw and Bob Lazier in 71, that's an RX-7. Second's an RX-7. And third is Bacon Reed and Millen. That also is an RX-7. In the GTO, it's a real battle between Ford and Chevrolet. Leading, Lynn St. James, Tom Gloy, and Bill Elliott, who, of course, you NASCAR guys know so well. Second is the Archer brothers and Lapalin in the 77 Camaro. Third is another Ford, Johnny Jones, only 20 years old. Tommy Riggins, of course, well-known down here. And Wally Dolan back there running third. And then Millen and Cora in a Toyota, turbocharged Toyota. So that's giving it a run.
Okay, David, that's just actually a Chevrolet. Wally Dallenbach, the champion in Trans Am, has moved over. Okay, what about your son? What is he going to face? And we've got a few seconds left in the darkness for the first time. How tough will it be on him?
Well, one of the most confusing things, he's driving the Camel Light category, which is not quite as quick as the bigger cars. And, of course, he's really surrounded by cars that are going a lot faster than him, and of course he's going faster than some of the others, so his depth perception is going to be a big problem.
Have you had a chance to wave at him yet?
No, I haven't waved at him yet.
Okay,
anyway, I'll wave at Ken instead.
David Hobbs' own car on pit road for the moment. Our next update will come at 7 o'clock Eastern during wrestling. Stay tuned here to the Superstation.
CBS Sports, continuing live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona, is brought to you by Budweiser, the genuine article. Beechwood aged for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. And by B.F. Goodrich TA Radials. TA Radials, tested tough to make your car perform.
3 hours, 26 minutes into the 24 Hours of Daytona, live here from the World Center of Speed. Three Porsche 962s are up in the top positions now, and the race has had an interesting development. Taking a look at the leaderboard at this moment, we see that Jochen Mass and Bruce Levin's car is up in front. Then the A.J. Foyt car is running in second. Last year's winners are in third. The Chevrolet is in fourth, and the Jaguar is running in fifth place. But the major story right now is that the B.F. Goodrich 962, third place finisher a year ago, and has been running third here, is in trouble. Let's go to Jerry Garrett.
Well, Ken, just moments ago, the number 67 car was wheeled behind the wall. We want to talk to team leader Jim Busby. What happened?
Well, we think we lost an engine. We can't really pinpoint it. It looks like something up in the valve gear let go.
One of those terminal things that there's no way to fix.
Well, they attempted to fix it, and they were going to try to pull the valve back up and just eliminate that cylinder and finish out on five cylinders, but we couldn't get the parts out from underneath the camshaft, so we thought better of it. We'll get ready for Miami.
Tough break for one of our front row starters.
More after this message. Faring better here tonight is the GTO leader. That's Greg Pickett, Terry Labonte, and Darrell Waltrip. They were just moments ago on pit road. There you see Waltrip climbing out, and Terry Labonte from Corpus Christi, Texas, climbing into that machine.
Okay, well, Darrell Waltrip just got out of the 28 car, which unofficially is leading GTO. He must be doing pretty good out there.
Well, actually, I think I drive better in the dark. I can't see the turns so good, so I'm running up on them a little harder. I really wasn't driving hard enough, and my times, I think, probably picked up just a tick after it got in the dark, but car's running beautiful, and the Protofab guys are doing a great job of keeping it going, and it's kind of fun.
At the STP Pit Center, here's Chris Ikonomaki.
Sitting with me is Wally Dallenbach Jr., two-time Trans Am champion who put more than 3 hours in at the wheel, got out of the car just a few minutes ago, and then had to stand agonizingly by while 6 minutes was used up to replace a battery, a brake light switch. What goes through your mind, Wally, if you've driven so hard and so long to watch a $1 part cause a delay like that?
Well, that's just this, Chris. When you come in and after all that work and we were running well and I think we were up in the top three, and then a little piece like that put us out, and not put us out, but put us back that far, it's going to be tough to make that time up. And those minutes tick by and they feel like about hours.
Well, I know you're 22nd overall, 8th in GTO, and your younger brother's going to take off pretty soon, isn't he?
Yes, he is. He's getting some good seat time here, and this is a great place to do it. My first time here was with Dan Gurney, and it really is a good place to get seat time. He's getting a lot of experience here, and it's really good for him.
Okay, now you learned the new expression, seat time, Ken.
Coming up next, there'll be more championship wrestling here on the Superstation, WTBS. So stay tuned, and we'll be back with you a bit later for more of the competition, where right now, car number 86, the Bruce Levin Porsche 962, driven by West Germany's Jochen Mass, is out in front. Next update following wrestling at 8 o'clock Eastern.
CBS Sports' continuing live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona is brought to you by Budweiser, the genuine article. Beechwood aged for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. And by B.F. Goodrich TA Radials. TA Radials, tested tough to make your car perform.
4 hours, 26 minutes, approximately 500 miles into the 24 Hours of Daytona. Ken Squire with you, and a crippled leader. Car number 86 has just hobbled onto pit road. That is the Bruce Levin car, the Porsche 962. A left rear tire went down. There was a report that the machine was in contact with another automobile, and they have given up first place. The A.J. Foyt car, being driven by Danny Sullivan at the present time, is now in first position. This car has been on pit road for some 4 minutes. There are the standings at the present time. Sullivan has now taken first place. Let's go to Jerry Garrett.
We're down here on pit road where our announcing colleague Lynn St. James has decided it's time to punch the clock and go to work, and Bill Elliott's gotten out of the car. Bill, how's it running now? You had to run in with the wall about a half an hour ago.
Well, I had a tire going down and ended up blowing out coming out of four, and I was about to took out two GTP cars. That was awful close. went out and we had a problem. It knocked the front end out on the car, but once they got that fixed, the car was running really well.
It's running sweet now for Lynn to go to work, right?
I didn't understand you.
It's running sweet now for Lynn to go to work.
No doubt about it.
Okay, Chris Economac is down pit road with another one of our in-car commentators.
Well, Bob Aiken is sitting here. Hans Stuck is in his car. You've had two 10-minute pit stops, Bob. Put you way down. Have you changed the battle plan?
Well, they happened pretty early, Chris, and so we haven't changed the battle plan yet. You know, each one was about 10 minutes, but we still want to save the car for the final hours.
Same tempo.
Same
Bob,
tempo.
I see you've changed clothes here, and I understand that you brought quite a wardrobe here. What's it all about?
Well, the driver's suits get pretty wet with perspiration during the drive, so you've got to let them dry out. So I have two spare driver suits and four sets of underwear, and I sort of change off and alternate, so I'm always dry.
Well, that's the way. We'll be back with more from the World Center of Racing after these messages. The pits have been being closed in here at the Daytona International Speedway. It's an interesting looking structure, 12 by 18 feet. There are 16 2x2 uprights with a lot of thick plyo film nailed to them, about 9 feet high. These are sold to the contestants by a franchise holder for $350. It helps keep the cold wind out. It helps keep interlopers out. But it makes it look like a shanty town. One of the car owners said he's been buying his own shed back every year for about 10 years. Another concession here at the World Center of Racing.
Thank you, Chris. The GTO category of competition has had a major change. The Archer brothers, the king of ice racing, in trouble out of Duluth, Minnesota. Their hopes melt as they had a collision with the wall in the back straightaway. And it has set this up in GTO. It's Labonte and Waltrip now running in first place with their Camaro. And then Baldwin and Lloyd, Jack Baldwin, a second Camaro, is running in the second position. And one of Dan Gurney's Toyota Celicas is maintaining third place overall in the field. The Levin car still on pit road. Foyt is in front. The Jaguar has come to second position here in the 24 hours of Daytona. Coming up next, the Superstation movie presentation, Heaven with a Gun, starring Glenn Ford and Carolyn Jones. Our next update, approximately 8:40 in the movie.
CBS Sports' continuing live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona is brought to you by Budweiser, the genuine article. Beechwood aged for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. And by Dodge, setting new standards of performance.
Good evening from the World Center of Speed. Ken Squire with you. We're 5 hours into the 24 hours of Daytona. 573 miles have been completed by the team of A.J. Foyt, Al Unser Sr. and Danny Sullivan, currently in car number one. In the same lap is Al Unser Jr. and then a couple of laps down, Bob Tullius in the Jaguar. Jerry Garrett has a report on the leader through the first 139 laps before trouble came to Bruce Levin.
Down here with Bruce Levin, the car owner in 86. What happened, Bruce?
Slower car hit us and took out the left rear suspension in the car, and the guys are trying to put it back together again.
How much downtime do you figure you're going to have?
Oh, it's going to be quite a bit. It's going to cost us the race, I think.
It's too bad. They're really running strong.
Okay, there's an interesting story here among the leaders. The A.J. Foyt car and the Bell Robinson-Unser car are both being managed by Al Hulbert, the former driver of this car. There's 11 seconds between these two cars, so Hulbert has got a bit of a management problem if they stay this way. Which car is he going to manage in the victory lane? This car has a 3-liter engine. This one, in the interest of reliability, a 2.8-liter engine, and Hulbert just told me that these drivers here are having a job keeping up. Okay, we'll be back for more at the World Center of Racing after these messages.
Competition. Here's Jerry Garrett.
We're here with Greg Pickett, who's about ready to get in and spell Terry Labonte in the GTO leading Chevrolet. You surprised how good these good old boys are doing out here at this road racing stuff?
No, not really. We figured they'd do a real good job. They certainly know their way around this place real good.
There, the car just humming along,
and then yeah, I started off, and when I turned it over to Daryl, we had about a 34-second leader, so I'm just going real easy, and it's still going along real well. Unfortunately, one of the other cars, the 77 car, fell out, which put us on the lead now, and Terry's on a real, Daryl been in, and Terry's been in now for a double shift, and just humming along real good. We're just being real gentle with it, you know, just coaxing her home.
Gotten along well? You have fun together out there?
Oh, very much so. Yeah, the guys are really a lot of fun, and and then listen, I was surprised. You know, they know that we have a lot of time in these cars and know these cars pretty well. So I think putting it on the pole down here too kind of good.
It's a three-way scramble in GTU competition. Rod Millen's Mazda RX-7 is currently leading. Let's check back with the report that Jerry Garrett filed earlier, with the car now in third place.
Okay, we're down here with Tom Kendall right now. And Tom, you guys have been in and out of the GTU lead all night. Seems like the car's running real good.
Yeah, we've had a real smooth race so far. Had one little problem where we got hit by one of the probes. I think the Zoxbeam one, and you know, just bent a wheel, so we had to stop. But we're just kind of trying to take it easy and make it through until the morning, and then see where we sit. And if we have to speed it up or slow it down, we'll, you know, adjust accordingly.
So there you see the car that had led through lap 139 with the exception of four or five laps. That's the Bruce Levin car coming back into action. It has fallen out of the top five, in fact, out of the top 10, and it's ready to roll once again here. Coming up next, the Superstation movie presentation, Heaven with a Gun. Following the movie, it's Motor Week Illustrated with Dave Despain.
Scene, including the Monte Carlo Rally, and watch the old guy win in a muddy Florida motocross. Stay tuned for excitement on television's fastest half hour.
Motor Week Illustrated is brought to you by Ford and your local Ford dealer, who invite you to see the 1986 Ford cars and trucks. Have you driven a Ford lately?
Wild light show. Look here what we've got. The 24 hours of Daytona action. The defending champion has moved out front. Al Holbert's team is leading this race, and we're going to update this American Racing Classic on a special edition of Motor Week Illustrated. Hello, everyone. I'm Dave Despain from the GM Goodrich race headquarters, where some guy just walked in here. I don't know who this is. Darrell Waltrip, how you doing?
Hi, David. How are you?
I got to tell you, right at the top, Danny Sullivan was supposed to be here, but he's out there fooling around with his race car.
Man, he showed up for nothing all week. Why would he be here tonight?
Now, they were leading the race there for a while. Doing pretty good here tonight.
That just goes to show, if I was leading the race, I may not be here either. But we are running pretty good in the GTO. So
we're going to talk about that, too. Before we do that, let me tell you about a couple of things. First of all, we got a power failure going on all over this racetrack. We're going to do our best to keep this thing on four wheels and bring you a special edition of Motor Week. The other thing I need to tell you is we're going to do more driver changes here tonight than these guys are out on the racetrack. We're going to start with Darrell Waltrip. What are you doing down here? You just playing around? Your race is 2 weeks from now, Daytona 500.
This is one of those deals. I don't want to do this. I only came down here to see if I could.
I see.
You know, it's kind of like, hey, I can't swim the English Channel, but maybe I can run 24 hours at Daytona. So I really just want to see if I can or not.
What we're doing is kicking off Speed Week. I think that's the big news. A new season of racing has begun with 5 weeks of nonstop action down here in Florida, and Motor Week is going to be covering it all. We'll go first up north, Jacksonville, Florida, last night. First big sprint car race of the year. Bob Barsha has the story.
Take it, Bob.
For a while, it seemed the All-Star Sprint Show would never get started. Pole sitter Kenny Adams foiled the first attempt when he spun. Then Robbie Dunn went over on his nose on the very first lap. Overheating brakes were a problem for several cars, including Rod Ritter here. 85 USAC dirt champ Rick Hood in orange number 5 held off the 29 of Doug Wolfgang until two laps to go, when Hood ran into the lapped car of Darren Esch. As Hood staggered, Wolfgang slipped under and held Hood at bay to the finish. Afterward, Doug admitted to a yearning to make the jump to Winston Cup stock cars, though his first try was less than auspicious.
I took a ride in a Winston Cup car here a couple weeks ago at Daytona, and I spun out. I didn't do so good, but I did run 196 mile an hour or something my first time out.
I think Wolfie'd make a heck of a sprint car driver. Did you ever drive one of those things?
When I was a little boy, I did. I rode a thing that looked like that at the carnival one time.
Where you were doing
all that turning and spinning.
Somebody said your car just went up in smoke. Is that right? We may keep you on here.
My
for the
car
whole...
went up in smoke. My race car.
Your race car. There you go.
I thought there were some restless natives out here. Maybe it did.
It is a wild night at Daytona. We're going to show you something right now that is the biggest rage in racing during this past winter, the one that we're just finishing. I'm talking about bomber stock enduros. This looks like Waltrip stuff. A couple hundred old junkers on a half mile slugging it out for 200 or 300 laps. Daryl, you'd love it. The Ultimate Enduro, 2 weeks from tonight, Orlando, 500 laps in Cadillacs and Jaguars and Mercedes, luxury cars, winner take all for $100,000.
Your old running buddy,
Rick Wilson, is going to drive the thing. He's the local favorite
Flip
in
Wilson.
A $30,000 brand new Olds Toronado.
Hey, go for it.
A little more serious note, Daytona 500 is coming up. You've never won it. Is this the year?
You know, I'm glad you brought that up.
I bet you are.
I didn't think you were going to. You know, I hope I can win this GTO division here in the 24-hour race. That'll be one more thing I've won beside the Daytona 500. But Waddell Wilson and the Tide crew is going to have that car running good. We're going to be in Talladega Monday testing. That car is going to be one of the front-running cars here. You can count on it.
Talk about Talladega. It's funny you should mention Talladega.
Uh-oh.
That brings to mind the name that is on a lot of people's lips. It's the name Bill Elliott. The reason? Well, you know, he won the race from the pole 2 years ago, went to Talladega this week, ran over 214 miles an hour, fastest lap ever in a stock car. Got a guy named Ivan Baldwin helping him out. There's Ivan. Will he win the pole next Saturday?
There's a lot of difference between Daytona and Talladega. Here at Daytona, you feel the speed a lot more than you do at Talladega. Talladega is built to run at speed. You know, here it's going to be a question of, you know, they'll have the motors tuned up, spoilers laid back and everything else, and it's going to be a hang-on session, and I just hope I can just brave it out for one lap.
Well, I'll tell you, he was brave last weekend. 214, the way I hear it, in a snowstorm and with the car getting airborne. They went back yesterday with a brand-new car, ran 213. My question to you, Daryl, you look at me like you don't believe that. Number one, is this getting airborne business a problem, and is 214 too fast?
It's my understanding that they have had a problem with the new Thunderbird being a little light at those high speeds, so maybe they over-engineered that big bird this time. I hope so.
Do Chevrolets stick to the racetrack at that speed, or do they run that fast?
Suck you right through the floorboard.
That right? So you're okay then? You're happy with your equipment?
I want to say hi to Stevie. She's watching us.
Yeah, I wish she could be down here enjoying this warm weather with us. Let me, where are we going to do next? I want to take you back because we are going to look at the GTO race. Right now, though, I want to get you back to the GTP division. Those are the big fire breathers up front, and we want to take a look at the highlights in the race thus far. It was a two-car race up front during the early going. You had the Porsche of Klaus Ludwig, the three-time Le Mans winner, out there doing battle with the Chevrolet Corvette of Cyril Vandermeer, but that thing runs 225 miles an hour. Look how they diced for the lead. Look just like stock cars on a Saturday night. Down to the bottom goes Vandermeer. Up around the outside comes the Porsche, and they haul it down the backstretch. That is Ludwig, the leader. Now down into the chicane they come, and as you can see, lap traffic is a big problem on this racetrack because those GTO drivers like Walter won't get out of the way.
They get out of
the banking here. Watch Vandermeer come into the chicane, pitch her in there sideways, run her off in the grass, flash the headlights, look out, I'm coming through. They made two pit stops because the thing kept running out of gas, and they dropped off the leaderboard. Great battle for fourth. Jaguar into the chicane, then a lap car. A.J. Foyt pinned up against the wall, and down to the inside comes Price Cobb, grabs the spot. 30 seconds later, Price is on the outside of the Jaguar. Watch this pass, Daryl. Locks her up, slides her in there, and that's your fourth place automobile at that moment.
I love it.
Let me tell you about the end of 6 hours in this race. Here is the situation as it looks now, and a lot of the lights around this place are out, so the ones that are working are on the race cars. At the six-hour mark, the team of Danny Sullivan, A.J. Foyt, and Al Unser Sr. were leading the race. They banked $500 from the True Value Hardware people. We've got True Value Leader of the Pack awards at 12 hours, another at 18 hours, and if Sully and company can stay out front, win all three, and win the race, they get a $1,000 bonus, total of $2,500 from True Value. Now here's a big story that's going to break next week. Team Lotus Grand Prix powerhouse has a multi-million dollar sponsorship deal from Camel Cigarettes, the parent company involved in Camel GT, Winston Cup, drag racing, motorcycles. The way we hear it, putting that Camel logo on two European race cars will cost as much as the entire Camel GT program in America. And federal authorities are looking for former Camel GT champ Randy Lanier. He's been indicted in connection with a marijuana smuggling ring, and Lanier is nowhere to be found. don't know if I can keep you around here or not. You stay with me for a minute, okay?
All right, buddy.
Because we may well want to talk to you some more about this GTO class. In any event, we're going to take a quick break right now. While we do that, let's check those GTP standings in the race thus far. These are the overall standings for the 24 hours of Daytona. As we see, it is still the Porsche 962 in front of the Jaguar. The Corvette's still in the thick of it, and we'll be back with more right after this. From the GM Goodrich race headquarters at Daytona, the 24 hours live here on TBS Sports. And look who's here. Motorweek regular Lynn St. James pops up in place of Darrell Waltrip. Thanks for coming by. Tell me why you're not on the leaderboard. What's going on?
Well, we were leading the class in GTO, and we had a tire go flat or cut a tire, and Bill ended up hitting the wall, and we had to replace the whole right front corner of the car. So we lost 15 laps, about 30 minutes, which should happened early, so we'll be able to catch it back up, but we're just not on the leaderboard right now.
It's a long
but
race.
We'll be there. You better believe it.
Bill, of course, is Bill Elliott. He's the teammate in that Mustang. The GTO class is really booming. It's supposed to be Ford versus Chevrolet. Let's see if we can pop the standings up here and take a look at the Toyotas moving in here to challenge. The Chevys are running up front. There's some guy named Jenner down there in fifth and a Ford. What's the story here? Is this an upset in the making? How about those Toyotas?
Well, those Toyotas, you know, are run strong. I mean, they're not as, they haven't been as quick sometimes, but they're very, you know, they've proven to be reliable and they've got some good drivers, but it's still early. I mean,
we've
got ways to go.
Let me change subjects for just a moment. Stay with me here. I want to know more about her GTO plans. But first, final episode in Motor Week's exclusive coverage of the world's longest race from Paris, France to Dakar in Africa. Bob Richards says that race has been revolutionized.
For 8 years, Paris Dakar racers have relied on a strategy of survival. They entered four-wheel drive vehicles with tons of reliability, backed by an army of support personnel and parts. They sought simply to wear down the competition. Well, this year, survival gave way to a different strategy, a strategy of speed. Former World Rally Champion Ari Vatanen rewrote the book in his bullet-fast Peugeot. In building a Paris-Dakar machine, the French automaker wrapped four-wheel drive technology in a 200-mile-an-hour package, unleashing a genuine race car on the unforgiving African desert. The experts, well, they predicted spectacular failure. Not enough reliability, they said. Sure enough, Vatanen's front suspension collapsed the first day. But quick repairs were followed by an incredible runaway. In his first race since a near-fatal crash last year, Vatanen streaked from 249th place to a three-hour lead. He flipped the car, flattened 15 tires, and still won this unique event by more than an hour.
To come back at all, to start the competition again, that was a dream coming true. And to do it in this fashion, it makes me speechless.
This is Bob Richards for Motor Week Illustrated.
I tell you, that guy's a piece of work. And Peugeot is coming to America in your class, GTO. Factory Turbo 505s late this year, full run for the championship next year. Look out. Your GTO deal lets you do something you've wanted to do for a long time. Tell me what that is.
You got it. I get to run the whole IMSA Camel GT circuit, my first time for a full season, and to go for a driver championship.
Can you win that thing against all those hairy-chested boys?
What a question.
Well, answer it.
Well, I'm there to do it, let me tell you. And I think it's great that everybody's coming in. It's going to make it for a better championship. And when Ford wins the Manufacturers' Cup, it'll just mean more.
Funny you should mention all those teams coming in, because that is precisely what Chris Economaki wants to talk about. He's down on pit road with more on that. Chris?
Major League road racing in this country is undergoing a dramatic change in emphasis. Last year, there were 25 fire-breathing prototypes in this race and 25 GTO cars. Today, only 15 prototypes. 9 of them Porsches took the green flag, but there were 27 GTO cars representing 7 different manufacturers: Ford, Chevrolet, Buick, Pontiac, Oldsmobile, Mazda, and Toyota. And with every GTO nameplate, there was a squadron of factory people, engineers, PR types, and in many cases, advertising agency representatives prepared to make the most when victory comes their way. With prototypes starting at $300,000, the less expensive GTO cars are finding more and more favor with entrants. But the big question is, will the fans buy GTO as the circuit traverses the country?
Well, my guess is yes. Chris, thank you for that. Steve Potter is a member of our TBS broadcast crew down here and the butt of a great many Motor Week jokes. He insisted on coming to Daytona by way of Wisconsin, where the Amoco Ice Racing stars gathered last weekend, and now he's going to tell us why.
I
I got my Hawaiian shirt. I got my sunglasses. I'm ready for some warm weather because I'm going to tell you it's cold here in Wisconsin.
But since Dave pokes so much fun at me all the time, I'd better tell you what happened in the race myself. My teammates, Bobby and Tommy Archer and Willie Lewis, managed to put our two Chevy Spectrum Turbos second and third on the grid. But at the start, pole sitter Jeff Brabham in his red Scirocco left us all in a cloud of snow. Brabham put on a great demonstration of car control until all that sliding around wore out his tires. But tires were just one key to racing on this frozen lake. The other was visibility. Snow and ice crystals kicked up by the cars made it so hard to see that my team began driving by the numbers. Head down the straightaway, count to five, and turn. Other drivers tried their own ideas. Some worked better than others. In fact, the visibility was so bad that the archers couldn't even get a good look at their own checkered flag. Believe me, it was there somewhere, because Willie and I were just behind in second, holding off the father and son team of Jerry and Terry Orr in their VW GTI. From frozen La Crosse, Wisconsin, this is Steve Potter.
I am not going to make fun of Steve this week.
I won't either, but I want to know where he got that shirt.
Don't you start on him. We're going to have to take another quick break here. Thank you for coming by.
Thanks.
I'm looking forward to seeing you all next season on Motor Week, okay? Lynn St. James, we're going to take another quick break. Let's see. We've got more interesting people to come in the GM Goodwrench Race Headquarters. You're going to need a pencil and paper here in a moment, and I want to update the Camel Light Division standings here in the race. Jeff Klein, the leader in the Pontiac, and we're going to have a whole lot more of the excitement of the 24 Hours of Daytona when we come back. Stay with us.
I, the Air Force Reserve.
If you're looking for a challenge, take it from me, Bruce Jenner, and join the winners. In today's Air Force Reserve, it's a great way to serve.
And by Yamaha. Just like world champion Eddie Lawson, number one is the only place you want to be. Ride a Yamaha FZ per... I, the Air Force Reserve.
If you're looking for a challenge, take it from me, Bruce Jenner, and join the winners. In today's Air Force Reserve, it's a great way to serve.
And by Yamaha. Just like world champion Eddie Lawson, number one is the only place you want to be. Ride a Yamaha FZ performance machine.
Here's what it looks like at night at Daytona International Speedway. Looks like a freeway, and the guy who's been negotiating that freeway traffic pretty effectively is with me right now. He has just climbed out of his race car and gotten all bundled up, and I'm talking about Danny Sullivan, former Indy 500 winner. What's it like out there anyway?
Well, it's actually the wildest I've ever seen it. We had a little problem in our Columbia Crest Special, and we were passing and racing with Little Al in the Lowenbrow car, and we ran up high coming on the banking, and he went low, and the guys moved up, and one guy drove me into the wall out there, and we damaged the nose and lost some ground, and I got it back and passed him, but it had damaged the nose enough to lose one of the headlights, so we spent about 4 minutes changing the nose when AJ and I switched.
So they made the driver change, lost the lead, but are still right there in contention in a long race. I want to talk more with Sully, but right now we want to turn our attention briefly to the Daytona 500 as opposed to the Indy 500. We have been following the recuperation of Darrell Waltrip's teammate on our GM Goodwrench Daytona updates, and we have more on that story today. Tim Richmond reportedly getting stronger after his bout with pneumonia. He'll probably test but not race at Richmond, Virginia the week after the 500. Tim's illness prompted his car owner Rick Hendrick to hire Benny Parsons for at least half the season, but Tim's job will be waiting when he comes back.
Tim's car 25 is available and ready, and as soon as he's available to get back in it, Tim will be driving the Folgers car, and we will have the option of keeping Folgers on the Benny's car or putting another sponsor on it.
All right, that's the word from Mr. Hendrick, and quite a car owner. It'd be fun to drive for him, huh?
I think he's great.
All right.
I've talked with him a couple of times, and I think he wants to emulate Roger Penske.
Yeah. We're going to be following a lot more Daytona news on our GM Goodwrench update next week, and we'll be back here 2 weeks live on the evening before the 500. Speed Weeks, of course, is a time for big racing announcements. We have one of our own. The 1st of April, Motor Week is going to take a major step. We're going to bring our weekly racing report to a lot more fans, moving off cable and onto commercial television stations nationwide. Now, Turner Broadcasting has been a wonderful home for us for 5 years, 262 editions, and we're going to leave in pretty spectacular style with three specials. Nationals. Next Friday night, 10:30 Eastern time. The following Saturday, back here at Daytona Live, the night before the 500 extravaganza. And 3 weeks from today, live from Richmond, Virginia, kicking off exclusive TBS Live coverage of the Richmond 400. Then, a five-week break to put the finishing touches on a new motor week, and then you watch those local listings. We'll be coming back at you on your local station the 1st of April. Also want to put up a very important address right now for you folks at home. Write this down and you could win a new Yamaha. To thank you for 5 years of support, we bring you the Yamaha Grand Prize Sweepstakes. Send us your name and address and you'll be in the running for an FZ700, great bike that brings Grand Prix technology to the street. We'll draw the winning name on the Richmond Show 3 weeks from today, so get those cards in the mail. Of course, motorcycles come down here to wrap up Speed Week in early March. And that reminds me of a guy who came down here 10 years ago and made a nickname for himself that he carries to this day. I'm talking about the Hurricane Bob Hanna. Bob wore Team Honda colors and was talking about retiring when he won the Daytona Supercross. That was 4 years ago. But this week, there's Bob, now on a Suzuki and much too old to be racing motocross, especially in conditions like this. Finals of the AMA Florida Winter Series ran in a swamp due to rain, and this is the hill that separated the old men from the young boys, which is JoJo Keller. Well, he did this in two classes to make some extra money. You decide. We take a look at Ronnie Tischner, definitely a young lion, close to his first championship of his career. Fried his clutch on that big hill and lost the crown. Meanwhile, old JoJo finally unmired himself in time to win the 500cc championship, and we'll show you some of the other strategies for dealing with Heartbreak Hill. The obvious was simple surrender. Some guys opted for the buddy system, had quite a few believers for that. My favorite, call a wrecker. But who do you suppose marched through the mud with the greatest of ease? You guessed it, that's the Hurricane. Bob Hanna blows through the Sunshine State just like he did 10 years ago, walks away with the 250 class championship, then passed up the champagne and cake for his 31st birthday because, well, he's in training for Daytona.
Daytona, I'm looking forward to. If I can, it's just about a month and a half off. If I can keep training and get a good start there and get lucky, have a few of those top boys fall on their head or something like that, I may win that one.
Tell you what, when you go out and win races at his age in those kind of conditions and beat all those young kids, you've earned yourself the honors as our champion spark plug racer of the week. Tell you what, Danny Solomon, we haven't sent one of those Racer of the Week plaques up your way for a while, but if you go out and win this thing this weekend, we might just have to do that.
Well, I'd like to have that. I've missed that, and it's been a long time, so we'll see if we can't bring it home tomorrow.
What a tremendous team you guys have. You, Foyt, and Unser Sr., the super team, 8 Indy victories among you. But you're a great road racer. This isn't alien to you, is it?
No, I haven't done many long-distance races, particularly 24-hour races. I think this is just my third 24-hour race. So, but I've done a lot of road racing. I enjoy it. I enjoy the night driving. And of course, with a team like that, you never have to worry about being let down for anybody. But not only 8 wins, I think there's 121 kart victories in that deal. So there's a few wins.
Talk about a record. We got another driver change here. Thanks for coming by. You guys stay warm and do good, okay?
Okay, thank you very much.
Danny Solomon, I'm going to give you a quick look at the GTU class standings here as we take another quick break. We're going to be back with the GM Good Ranch race headquarters right after this timeout. Hours of Daytona, and in a sense, I guess we've saved the best for last because the man who joins me now at the GM Goodrich Race headquarters is the driver of the car that's leading the race, Derek Bell. Good to see you.
Thank you, Dave.
The story? You got a lap and a half on the field, and you said don't ask me why, and so obviously that's my first question.
Well, we've been really the underdogs all weekend. We're running a smaller engine than most of the others, and it's just been a very hard battle. When I was out there, and I know when Chip was out there, we drove absolutely flat out for the whole race. It was really very, very hard, like a 3-hour race, not a 24-hour, and I began to wonder just how long the whole car was going to last. But we kept the pressure up, and some of the others have had problems.
Well, the obvious question is, if you're having to work the car that hard, will it last 24 hours?
Well, the reason we ran the smaller 2.8 engine is we feel the engine will last, and so consequently, that's the philosophy behind our moves. But it's a bit hard out there when the other guys pull away from you in acceleration.
Okay, the ultimate frustration. This man is truly a jet-set racer, hopping back and forth across the Atlantic all the time. I'm sure you could tell us a story or two about wild nights in Monte Carlo, which is, of course, the jet-set capital of the world. That city is famous for its love of motorsports. And today, Jerry Garrett has the story of the 55th running of the Monte Carlo Rally.
The 87 World Rally Championship Series opened up in familiar and glamorous surroundings, but it had a very new look. In the wake of disastrous crashes last year, new rules dictate smaller and less powerful cars. Modified street machines now replacing all-out racers. Protesting those rules, the defending champion Peugeot team pulled out of the series. But Volkswagen, Audi, Mazda, and Subaru fielded huge Monte Carlo efforts. Their goal, to upset the favored Lancia factory team. Leading the three-car Lancia charge was Juha Kankkunen of Finland, who won the world championship in a Peugeot last year and then switched to the Italian team. Kankkunen's teammate Bruno Sabi of France took a turn at the lead, and so did Italian Mickey Biasion, as the Lancia staged one of the most exciting lead-swapping duels in Monte Carlo history. Late in the race, Kankkunen emerged as the apparent winner. Sabi was knocked out when his transmission exploded, and Biasion was more than a minute behind. But at the start of the final stage, the Lancia team manager ordered Kankkunen to slow down and let Biasion win. The outraged Kankkunen slowed down all right, literally idling through the final miles in protest and settling for second place. So the Italian team's favorite son, Mickey Biasion, is the Monte Carlo winner, perhaps with an asterisk. The season of change is underway, and it appears politics will once again mix with horsepower in the race for the world championship. For Motorweek Illustrated, this is Jerry Garrett.
And from the international scene, we go to the world of big business. When corporate raider James Goldsmith attempted to take over Goodyear, there were dire predictions that big tire company would pull out of racing. Well, this week, our stock car reporter, Benny Phillips, ventured into a rare North Carolina snowstorm to assess the pre-Daytona tire situation.
There was a time just a few short weeks ago when it seemed that Goodyear Racing might be left out in the cold, but that isn't the case anymore.
At Huggins Tire Company in High Point, North Carolina, the primary supplier of Winston Cup rubber, they are loading the year's biggest shipment headed for Daytona.
For the 500, we took 2,800 tires. We used 2,700 and some tires last year.
2 months ago, Thurman Huggins would not have given the price of a recap for his chances of supplying Daytona tires this year.
Well, it looked very dim, very bleak. We thought that we would be out of business.
Wall Street says it cost Goodyear $2 billion to stop that hostile takeover attempt. Racing's share of the bill is $20 a tire. The cost of each racing tire has been increased from $159 to $179. Car owner Richard Childress bought 125,000 worth of Goodyears en route to the 1986 championship, and he'll spend a lot more than that this year.
Around $200,000 is what we're anticipating on the tire bill, unless you win races. This year, the winner will get 10 free sets of tires, which last year we won five races, would have been 200 tires.
Give or take some bonus tires, top teams will spend an extra $75,000 for racing rubber this season. But those who make a living at 200 miles per hour certainly aren't complaining.
It's something that we have to have. It's a necessity that you got to have, is a good, safe tire, and Goodyear supplies us with that.
They're all just thankful that we do have tires to run instead of being out completely.
Financial stories are supposed to have a bottom line. In this case, where will the extra tire money come from?
It's got to come from somewhere. That means we just got to run a little harder and make a little more money.
In desperate need of snow tires, for Motorweek Illustrated, I'm Benny Phillips.
Benny, you need to get on down here to Daytona, my friend. It was sunny and warm this morning when our Ken Squire visited with the head man at Goodyear Racing.
Director of Worldwide Racing for Goodyear is with us. Leo, are you folks really out of the woods as you get to 1987?
Well, Ken, we've had to make some adjustments in our support programs, but our technical program, our production program is strong like before. We've got 20 years of experience, and we're looking forward to a competition in 87.
One of the most important elements in motorsports, folks have put the rubber to the ground. The Goodyear folks to receive our award, and here is Colonel Charles Ramsdale, U.S. Air Force Reserve, to make that presentation now.
Leo, it's a pleasure for me to represent the Air Force Reserve and to recognize you as this week's Air Force Reserve Behind the Scenes Award winner. You and your crew work so hard with all the other crews on the racetrack that it's a real pleasure, and the trophy reads, Leo Mill, the Air Force Reserve Behind the Scenes Award winner, 31 January 1987, and congratulations to you, sir.
Thank you, Colonel. As an Air Force veteran, I really appreciate the award.
Thank you, Leo, for coming by. David, before we give it back to you, one other important piece of business to do here. I don't go anywhere without my scrapbook, and now it's time to turn to another page from it.
February 1974, Daytona Beach, Florida. In deference to public outcry over the nationwide gasoline shortage, the Daytona 500 was shortened to 450 miles for the first and only time ever. Late in the race, Richard Petty and his number 43 Dodge were locked in a battle with Donnie Allison driving the number 88 Chevrolet of the newly formed DieGuard Racing Team. Suddenly, Petty swung into the pits with a cut tire, virtually handing the race to Allison. But with barely 10 miles to go, Bob Burcham blew his engine, and Allison cut a tire in the debris. Braking hard to avoid passing the pit entrance, Allison spun into the infield. And with Lady Luck riding alongside, Richard Petty took the checkered flag. The one and only Daytona 450 of 1974 became King Richard's fifth victory in NASCAR's showcase event. I'm Ken Squire. Join me next week for another great motorsports memory.
Well, there's every reason to believe that this 24 hours of Daytona will go the full distance. Perhaps I could get Derek Bell to make me a prediction of what we'll see in the next 17 hours.
Well, having seen the last six and a half, I dread to make any prediction at all. I thought there'd be a bunch of about a dozen really fast cars there all the way through the race, and it seems to have fallen apart at the seams. It's amazing how drivers just don't seem to really look at a race and think this is 24 hours, not a six-hour sprint, you know, and the whole thing falls apart. The Jaguar is going very strongly. Obviously, we've got a big battle on with Mr. Foyt and Mr. Sullivan, and obviously Alonso Sr. They're driving extremely well. And, of course, there's 17 hours to go, so anything can happen. It's still early, early days.
Well, you've certainly anticipated my next question. I wondered who the big challengers were going to be. These guys are still leading the race. I've got some other quick notes from elsewhere around the world of motorsports that are just in, and I want to pass them on. Drag racing, the quickest 16-car field ever in pro stock racing, is gathered in Pomona, California, and that's the season opener for the NHRA. Bob Glidden is the quickest in pro stock. Top Fuel, have you ever heard of Hank Endros from New Jersey? Well, I have, but he's never won a national. He is the top qualifier in Top Fuel. Funny car, Kenny Bernstein set a new national ET record to become top qualifier. And we've got, I believe, a bit of videotape we can show you of the Iron Man. That is, of course, Ivan Stewart in his truck. This guy was in the hospital the last couple of weeks with a back injury, went out to the opener of the desert racing season, the Parker 400, led it almost all the way, and then the car broke, the truck broke, and so it goes. At the 24 hours of Daytona, I recall this man, Derek Bell, making a quote, quote, 24-hour races are purgatory because they go on all night long.
Sunday, when the sun starts coming up, it's like you're a new person again. It renews you. You're really on it to make it the rest of the way from that point on. That is the goal for every team here, is to see daylight.
He ought to write a book.
That's great, isn't it? Daytona sunrises are special. This guy's going for the finish. We're getting out of here. We'll be back in 1 hour with another report from Daytona. I'll see you next Friday night on Motor Week. So long, everybody.
Promotional fee and consideration paid by Mr. Goodwrench and General Motors Parts. Nobody knows your GM car like Mr. Goodwrench. No one. and by Jaguar. Jaguar's racing V12 sets the standard for a distinctive, elegant, all-around touring car. The Jaguar XJS, a blending of art and machine.
Sports, continuing live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona, is brought to you by Dodge, setting new standards of performance. And by BF Goodrich TA Radials. TA Radials, tested tough to make your car perform.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are 8 hours and 16 minutes officially into the 25th running of the 24 Hours of Daytona. And we've gone through a shift change here in our exclusive live TBS coverage of one of the world's great sports car race. I'm Bob Varsha with you in our announce position. Bob Richards is standing by in our pit communication center. Bill Hennessy is along pit road. We are officially 38,839 miles into this silver anniversary event. Let's go down to the PCC now at Bob Richards to bring us up to date.
Thank you very much, Bob. We've been watching the number 14 Porsche 962 team that is in the lead. That car leading the race right now. That car won the race last year. Porsches have dominated this event, winning it the last 10 years, and they are doing awfully well once again. In second place right now, another Porsche 962, AJ Foyt currently driving that car. A lot of Indy experience here. As a matter of fact, 8 Indy wins in that car. Now in third place, a bit of a surprise, a Corvette. At the beginning of our broadcast at 3 o'clock Eastern time earlier today, we heard that skeptics say if a Corvette can possibly contend in this event, it'll be a major miracle. And right now they are in third place. We're going to keep our eye on that for the rest of the night. Right now, Bill Hennessy is in the pits, in the leaders' pits. Let's go to Bill right now.
The Porsche Meister for the USA is, of course, Al Hulbert, the defending champion both of this race and of the series. Al, the car looks like it's running on a rail at the present time. We understand there's a possibility you may don your gear and get in that car before the night's over.
No, I don't think I'd do that. Of course, if one of the guys needed help, I would, but, you know, I have three of the best guys there are, and two of them could really do it if they had to, but they've worked too hard to give up any of the glory.
Is it tedious sitting here on the pit wall watching that car go by?
Well, of course it is, but obviously just to keep occupied is important. It's a new deal for me.
Thank you, Al Hulbert. We'll be back with more continuing coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona in moments.
Of Daytona, you're watching the leader, the number 14 Porsche 962, currently being piloted by Chip Robinson. Now another class here, the GTO class, and a pretty good story starting to develop. This has been an American-made dominated class right now, and we see a Toyota in third place. So Toyota, it's been a very good night for them so far, but currently Jack Baldwin's team leading. Pickett is in second. Now we're going to be back with another update an hour from now. Right now, let's go back to more Night Tracks on WTBS.
TBS Sports, continuing live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona, is brought to you by BF Goodrich TA Radials. TA Radials, tested tough to make your car perform.
You watch the circulating lights of race cars at Daytona International Speedway in Daytona Beach, Florida. Hello, everyone. I'm Bob Varsha, welcoming you back to our exclusive live coverage here on TBS of the 24 Hours of Daytona, the 25th annual event. We've been with you for the last five and glad to have you with us. Just over 9 hours ago, some 69 cars started this race. We now have 57 still running. Not bad attrition for a 24-hour race, though we must admit that some of the exits have been a little bit more spectacular than others. I'll give you a case in point, that being our defending champions in the GTO, that is the production-based big muscle car category. Just moments ago, the defending champions in that class, the Ford Mustang of Maurice Hasse, Lanny Hester, joined by Ken Johnson, caught fire explosively right on the front steps below our announced position here. Here's a look at it, the fire burning in the back, very near the fuel cell. Driving at the time, I believe, was Maurice Hasse. He got out of it in a hurry, as you can see. The fire in the gas tank area quickly brought under control. We're happy to say nobody was hurt. No yellow flag. The race has continued apace. While we watch that, let's take a look now at our leaders at this point in the race. Some 11,000 racing laps and over 40,000 racing miles into this race. The number 14 Porsche 962, presently driven by Derek Bell, is right out front of the big GTP category. In the GTO category, that is the big production-based cars, the Terry Labonte, Darrell Waltrip, Greg Pickett entry being driven by Pickett right now. It says Labonte there in red, but Pickett is now in that car. GTU, the Amos Johnson, Jeff Klein entry is running in first position right now. And in Camel Lights, it is Bob Earl and Don Bell out front right now. Bob Richards is standing by, as is Bill Hennessy down on pit road. Let's hear from Bill right now.
Well, Cyril Van de Merwen, along with Doc Bundy in the Hendrick Motorsports number 52 Corvette, while running third, experienced terminal problems. Their car has been sidelined and withdrawn from the 24 hours of Daytona with problems in the valve train assembly. We're with Roger Mandeville. Roger has finished third and second in class here at the 24 hours of Daytona. It was a brand new effort for the 87 season with a GTO car, three-rotor Mazda. Problems in the early going.
Well, we had a slight problem with the right caliper. It has since been changed, and the car's running beautifully. No problems now.
A little combative nature out on the course. Moments ago, you wrenched your shoulder when one of the GTP cars slammed into the side of you.
Well, I would imagine GTP cars are pretty hard to drive at night, pretty hot, and I guess that guy was super tired and didn't see where he was going.
Roger Mandeville will be continuing in the 24 hours of Daytona when he climbs back in the car. We're going to take this break, and we'll be back in moments.
Our live coverage of the 24 hours of Daytona. Let's go down to Bob Richards now in our STP Pit Communication Center.
Thank you very much, Bob. As Bob was saying earlier, we have 12 cars out of the race and 57 running, and we do have some big names, some big cars out of the race. A little bit earlier, the number 86 Porsche 962 of Bruce Levin dropped out. The BF Goodrich team, number 67, that was on the outside pole, is also out of the race. So the front pole, both of the front row people are out of the race, and we also have the number 44 Jaguar, the underdogs every single year. They had problems once again. So that is what the story right here at the 24 hours of Daytona. We are going to have another update for you in about an hour from now. We'll have all the latest here. Goodbye. We'll see you a little later.
Continuing live coverage of the 24 hours of Daytona is brought to you by BF Goodrich TA Radials. TA Radials, tested tough to make your car perform.
Powerful driving headlights continue to circulate around the 3.56-mile Daytona Beach, Daytona International Speedway in Daytona Beach, Florida. Hello, everyone. I'm Bob Varsha. Welcome you back to another in this series of live updates from the 25th 24 hours of Daytona. Just over 10 and a half hours into this classic sports car distance run, and an eventful 60 minutes it has been. Just after we left you in our last update, fire struck the fourth place Porsche 962 being driven by endurance veteran Brian Redmond. An apparent turbocharger fire spread throughout the engine compartment of this $300,000 machine. As you can see, the fire spread quickly and burned fiercely. But fire extinguishers were brought to bear quickly, and although the car was terribly damaged, Redmond got away in good shape and talked shortly after with our Bill Hennessy in the pit area.
Of a $55,000 Porsche racing engine. That's what I'm holding in my hand. It was a very expensive evening and an outing for you, Brian Redmond.
Extremely expensive. Those might be the most valuable pieces of metal that you'll ever hold in your hand.
These aren't going to be very fond remembrances of the 24 hours of Daytona for you, are they?
Well, I suppose I've done 22 24-hour races now between Daytona and Le Mans. I finished about five of them. That tells you what 24-hour races are like.
Brian Redmond, expensive afternoon drive here at the 24 hours of Daytona.
As that drive turns into an evening, we'll take a look at the top five now. In the absence of the number 8 car, Al Unser Jr. in the number 14 Porsche leads his father, Al Unser Sr. Rob Dyson in the number 16 Porsche in third. Massimo Sigala in one of the great foreign entries. The Brune Motorsports team from Germany now moves into the fourth position. The Hotchkiss machine, another father-son team driving together in fifth position. We'll be back with more from Daytona right after this. Live, you're watching the leader, Al Unser Jr., circulating Daytona International Speedway, but there's big news also in the GTO category for production cars. Let's go down now to pit road and Bill Hennessy.
Well, Dan Gurney is standing vigil here in his pits. His car's running first and third. Dan, do things appear to be going well here?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
I said, do things appear to be going well for the two cars at the present time?
We're real pleased with it right now. Of course, the race is just about halfway.
Usually this is when things start breaking early in the morning now. I know that you want to maintain your good luck here at Daytona and bring those cars home first and second.
Well, we sure do. By the way, how's the America's Cup going?
I wish I knew. Dennis Aussie, how's he getting along?
I'm sorry I can't hear.
How's Dennis doing?
He's doing very well, and he may be watching this broadcast.
Of course, he's referring to Dennis Aussie, his driver who was injured out in California not long ago. From the 24 Hours of Daytona, I'm Bill Hennessy.
Okay, thank you, Bill. As Bill mentioned,
TBS Sports, continuing live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona, is brought to you by Coors and Coors Light, beers with a difference worth tasting.
Temperatures are in the low 30s at Daytona International Speedway at about a quarter after 3 on a Sunday morning. Hello, everyone. I'm Bob Barsha, welcoming you back to our live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona. Let's take a look at the top five as they stand at this hour. It's a Porsche parade. German makes 1 through 5 in the GTP and overall categories, led by Al Unser Jr., Chip Robinson, and Derek Bell in the number 14 car. Earlier, our Bill Hennessy had a chance to talk with the newest member of that Al Unser Junior team, Chip Robinson.
There's nothing like driving the lead car in a race the 24 Hours of Daytona. Chip Robinson, what an experience it is, moving up from a normally aspirated Jaguar into the number one team on the circuit.
Well, it's been fantastic so far. Things are going really smoothly. We're in pretty good shape, I think. We've got about a 5-lap lead, even though that can go away awfully quickly in this race.
It's got to be a tough transition to go around the clock for a guy that's normally involved in sprint racing. Physically, is it wearing on you?
Well, I've been training pretty hard, so right now I'm in pretty good shape. We've been doing double shifts, which is 2 fuel loads. It's about 2 hours and 10 to 15 minutes. And I feel pretty good right now. I think the next one's going to tell the story. If I can get through that one all right, I think we'll be in good shape.
What is the one major obstacle you're having to overcome racing around the clock?
Well, I think the biggest obstacle is just the endurance, not only of the driver, but of the crew and the car, and just, not making any mistakes, realizing that it is a 24-hour race, and keeping that in the back of your mind as you're trying to still be aggressive out there.
Thank you, Chip, and best of luck. Hope to see you tomorrow afternoon at 3:30.
Thank you.
Ah, yes, there's nothing like leading. We'll be back with more live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona right after these words. Live at the 24 Hours of Daytona, where the GTO class for the big bore production-based sports cars has become quite a story. At this point, it's looking like it might be a Toyota sweep, and the reason for that is problems in the Chevrolet camp. Steve Potter has more on that story.
I'm with Charlie Seelis of the Protofab Camaro team. Charlie, what happened when your driver, Darrell Waltrip, came in with a steaming radiator?
Well, we got a little hole in the radiator about 3 hours ago, with a little sealer in it. And hopefully we were thinking it would work, but it kept getting worse and worse to where we had to bring it in and change the radiator. And it cost us about 15 minutes, but I'm sure we'll make it up.
Charlie, the engine must have gotten pretty hot. Do you think it can live for the rest of 24 hours?
Oh, yeah. Darrell, I told him to run it no higher than 235. As soon as it got there, he called me and he says it's getting there, and he brought it right in. So I don't think we heard it. Hopefully.
Okay.
We'll be back with another update in about an hour. We're open all night in Daytona. See you later.
Continuing live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona is brought to you by Coors and Coors Light, beers with a difference worth tasting. Sports. Continuing live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona is brought to you by Coors and Coors Light, beers with a difference worth tasting.
You're looking live at Daytona International Speedway, where we have had a lead change. Hello, everyone. I'm Bob Barsha. Just moments ago, after 190 laps in the lead, the team of Chip Robinson, Al Unser Jr., and Derek Bell suffered a nightmarish pit stop and quickly turned a four-lap lead into a two-lap deficit. That's the bad news for our team, but first, some good news for that team. And for that, let's go to Bob Richards in our STP Pit Communications Center.
Thanks, Bob. Yes, we do have some good news for Al Unser Jr. We're going to give out our True Value Leader of the Pack Award. At the six-hour mark, it was Sullivan, and now at the 12-hour mark, it's Al Unser Jr. He gets a check for $500. But as Bob said, they did suffer a nightmare pit stop. For more on that, let's go to Steve Potter right in the pits.
I'm with Kevin Doran, the crew chief on the Hulbert Racing team. Kevin, your car came in at the same time as the number one car. They left and your car was in for 15 minutes. Tell us, what happened?
Well, we came in for a routine brake pad change, and Al Unser Jr. was driving, had a suspicion of a right front suspension problem, and we had to replace the right front hub assembly with a failed bearing. So the brake pad change would have taken 3 minutes, and we spent 15 minutes to change the brakes and the hub.
We'll be back with more racing from Daytona right after this.
Back at our live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona, we have a new leader, Danny Sullivan, driving on behalf of A.J. Foyt, and Al Unser is the new leader in the race. But we want to tell you about another leading team, that in the Camel Lights division, Bob Earl in a Pontiac Fiero GTP, driving with Don Bell and Jeff Klein, are now the leaders. And a little bit earlier, our Bob Richards had a chance to talk with Jeff Klein.
Standing by with Jeff Klein, and Jeff, you own a significant record. You have won a race with 12 different co-drivers. You're leading right now in Camel Lights. How do you get along with all these different drivers?
Well, it's amazing. I don't know if I can even remember who all the 12 were, but you know, in this business, you get a chance to drive a car, you better jump at it, and I've been fortunate enough to win several times with different people.
You're in the Fiero in this event. The car had never been over 6 hours before, so we're into kind of a new era. How's the car going?
Well, the AT&T Pontiac's doing just great. We're ahead by a lap, I believe, at this point. And we're really surprised and very pleased. All the development work they've done over the winter has really paid off. And we're looking forward to passing 12 hours. Then we know we can also win Sebring. So
the key to winning this race, we were talking a little bit earlier, consistency.
Really is. If you're not consistent and you're not there at the end, you're not going to win. And, you know, mechanical breakdowns happen, but if you make a driving mistake and put yourself out, you know, you have a whole year to kick yourself in the butt. So consistency is the key.
Thank you very much. Jeff Klein, his Pontiac Fiero, currently number one in Camel Lights. Now up to Bob Barsha in the tower.
Okay, thanks, gentlemen. Couple of important numbers at the 12-hour mark. 16,472 racing laps of this 3.56-mile Daytona International Speedway circuit. That totals 58,640.32 official miles of racing thus far, just about twice around the world. Lots more to come in our continuing coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona. See you about an hour from now.
Live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona is brought to you by B.F. Goodrich TA Radials. TA Radials, tested tough to make your car perform.
The only tranquility is here on Lake Lloyd in the center of the infield at the world center of speed, the Daytona International Speedway. 16 hours, 56 minutes into this 24-hour, twice round-the-clock grind, and we have a battle that has first and second place separated by only 11 seconds. Good morning, I'm Ken Squire. In our updates here on the Superstation, A.J. Foyt, twice a winner here, 1983, 1985. His car is in front by 11 seconds over the Al Holbert team that won here just a year ago. It's been an incredible battle through the night, and it's been heating up over the past hour. Now we're taking a look at the interval. There you see A.J. Foyt's car currently being driven by three-time Indianapolis winner Al Unser Sr., and we're looking for second place to give you an idea of the interval on this 3.56-mile course. And there it is, car number 14. It's Robinson currently at the helm, sharing the driving chores with Derek Bell and Al Unser Jr. It's a long, there's the leader again. It's a long, hard pull through the night. You've used up all your uniforms. You may have two or three uniforms, but right now they're all clammy and cold as you climb back in. It dropped below 40, nearly to freezing last night. There you see the standings. And notice third and fourth. There's a tremendous fight going on there. The Italian team, that is Lorare Sagala, Brancatelli, fighting with a Dyson car. And just moments ago, that Dyson car moved up in front of them in the Italian organization. They're five laps down from the leader at the present time. It is a great race here at Daytona. I can't ever recall one as close as this at this point. And we'll be back with more on the 24 Hours of Daytona. A look at the GTO class and others in a moment. Unser Sr. leading. Up, we have a late update from the pits. Let's go to Steve Potter.
Wonderful breakfast, eggs, ham, potatoes, fruit salad, but Ken, I think this story is going to take a little bit more investigation. Could you get back to me in a couple of minutes?
All right, we'll try to get back to you a little later. It's breakfast time here at Daytona at the STP Pit Center. Here's Dave Despain.
Let's take a quick look at another great race, Ken. We said, what was it, 17 hours ago, GTO would be a great battle. The stock car heroes are gone. The Chevys have been breaking for the first time in 24-hour history. Toyota leading the class. Millen & Cord out front. The charge is coming from a Ford that had early problems. Lynn St. James, Tom Bloy, Bill Elliott in a Mustang have gotten help from Scott Pruitt, former champion in this division. His GTP car broke. He climbed in the Ford, has helped charge back through the field, and right now, that is your battle. The other Toyota is third. This car, Rice, Fangio, and Rudd, has been having overheating problems, but that is a great battle in GTO. We'll have more on it later.
Meanwhile, A.J. Foyt's car stays out in front. Unser Sr. at the controls. Coming up next, more Tom and Jerry cartoons, and we'll be back live from Daytona at 9:25 Eastern.
CBS Sports, continuing live coverage of the 24 Hours of Daytona, is brought to you by Budweiser, the genuine article. Beechwood aged for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you.
Nearly 18 hours have been completed. 1,980 miles have been run. Hello, I'm Ken Squire here at the 24 Hours of Daytona. Our live updates continuing on the Superstation. There you see car number one, the Foyt car, Al Unser Sr. driving, still in front by just seconds over Al Unser Jr. running second place overall in the event. The GTO has had some action in the past hour. Here's the leader, Foyt's automobile. Let's review the GTO standings. Right now, it is the Toyota Celica out in front. Then Lynn St. James' car is running in second place at Ford, followed by another Celica with Ricky Rudd currently at the controls. Take a look further back. Number 22, Scott Pruitt. He is running fourth in class, running 10th overall, and this is what happened to him just moments ago as they came to the tri-oval area. Down the main straightaway, being lapped by the leader, the entire nose piece comes off, the front clip comes up, Pruitt at 160 miles an hour, guides the car to the bottom of the track, and brings it in. Jerry Garrett talked with Scott Pruitt.
Well, Scott Pruitt, what happened? It looked like the whole nose of your car flew off. all of a sudden?
Well, that's what happened. I was just going along, and the Porsche went firmly, and when a turbulence came by, it just blew the whole front end off the car.
Does it shatter the windshield? Is the driver worn off?
Well, we're going to try and get it back together. We've got to brace the nose frame, the windshield, and some front bodywork. Hopefully, we'll get it going again.
Okay.
Remarkably, in about 20 minutes, they had that car back on the track. Scott Goodyear is now driving. Car number 22, still unofficially in 10th place. More in a moment.
Today, let's give away some money. True Value Hardware, leader of the pack award for 18 hours, goes to Al Unser Sr. Keep it all in the family. Junior got the last one. Sullivan got the first one. $500 apiece to the leaders of the pack here. Let me take a quick walk over here to talk with Bob Aiken, who has climbed out of his car after a driving stint. Could the wind alone have blown the front off of Scott Pruitt's car?
Well, Dave, looking at the replay, it didn't look like there was any contact at all. There's got to be a lot of turbulence at that speed. It looked like he just got some lift when the bodywork is not designed to have lift, and it just pulled it right out.
Nothing broke inside.
Well, there's a lot of machinery in that nose piece, so it's amazing that they've got the car going again.
You had a special interest in that car.
Yeah, my son Bobby's been slugging it out in that car all for the last 18 hours. He did a three-hour stint last night. He's all excited that they're running about 10th place.
Father and son teams are a big story here. The defending champion is also a story. Let's go to Jerry Garrett.
Well, Al Holbert is kind of captaining both of these cars. And does one of these cars, the one of the 14, have an advantage at this point?
Well, it looks like the number one car has got a little longer legs than the other car. He's running a slightly bigger motor, but, you know, it's so marginally different. It's just really a tremendous race, and credit to the drivers.
Okay. Don't forget our wrap-up show at 3:05. It commences this afternoon. Coming up next on the Superstation, the Andy Griffith Show. Our next update from Daytona following good news at 10:30 a.m. Eastern.
Battles in the 25-year history of the 24 Hours of Daytona. Welcome back to Daytona International Speedway, where the two cars that have swapped the victory here the last 2 years are at it again. This car won a year ago. Derek Bell, Al Unser Jr. were in the wheel. Chip Robinson, the new member of that team, and they're back out front again. Hot on their heels, the so-called super team. AJ Foyt, Al Unser Sr., Danny Sullivan, eight IndyCar, Indy 500 victories among them. They are chasing the leaders. It's been a lead-swapping battle all night. It looks like it'll go all the way to the finish. Quickly, the Camel Light Division, great story. Jeff Klein had a huge lead. His car broke, stopped out on the racetrack. Looked like they were out of the event. Klein got out his toolbox, got it running, got back onto pit road, and there they were able to effect repairs on the cars and get back out in third place. Gives us a new leader in the Camel Light class. 53-year-old Augie Papps, the brewing executive, the 1959 USAC champion and old sports car racer who last drove this race 24 years ago and crashed. His car is back out front. Current driver Tom Bagley is a second-generation racer. We'll be back with more right after this.
In the 24 Hours of Daytona, the leaders averaging 111 miles per hour, 6 miles per hour over any existing record. Hello again. I'm Ken Squire, our old racing sidekick. Bill Adam is back with us. What's working, what isn't out here?
Well, I'm not working for the rest of the day as far as a race car goes. Our Morrison Cook Corvette suffered a terminal engine failure, and for the rest of the field, it's really somewhat of a mystery. It's been a very, very good temperature for racing, cool temperatures that keep the turbochargers at a very nice operating temperature, but there have been some very strange blowups. The Jaguar is out, a lot of the very, very fast
Corvette
cars.
Is out.
Corvette is out, of course, that was the dark horse.
And the Ford went away, David Hobbs.
Ford is gone. It just shouldn't have happened. This should have been an absolutely perfect race for a tremendous long battle with 20 cars. Now we're down to the final five or six really good ones, but still, incredible race.
Well, like so many things in life, there are no shoulds. What do you think about this 118-mile-an-hour lap that's being turned out by the cars in first and second place, those Porsche 962s?
It's very surprising at this point. Shouldn't be this quick, but it is.
All right, we'll be back with more from Daytona in a moment. 5 this afternoon, and right up in front, we'll condense many of the highlights in our Valvoline update. So stand by at 3:05 for that this afternoon. The intrepid Bob Richards went out into the darkness and brought us back a report about what goes on where the majority of folks watch this race.
My shift ended at about dawn this morning. The all-nighter was over, but the fun was just beginning. The trip through the Daytona infield on the morning of the 24 hours is one you won't soon forget. Staying warm was the top priority for these hardcore fans. How did they do it?
A cold beer, that's all I need.
Not everyone was interested in just a liquid breakfast. A lot of people came a lot better prepared, even if the menu was a little bit on the simple side.
Got the stove here, what's for breakfast?
Bacon.
Just bacon?
Just bacon.
In the frying pan right now is this car at 118 miles per hour. Our next update during the movie at 11:07 Eastern.
This live coverage of the 24 hours of Daytona is brought to you by Budweiser, the genuine article. Beechwood aged for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. And by Dodge, setting new standards of performance.
19 hours, 33 minutes into the silver anniversary, 24 hours of Daytona. Hello again, I'm Ken Squire. And while the Al Hulbert 962 leads the A.J. Foyt car by about a minute, there's a tremendous battle continuing in the GTO class. For the first time in the 25-year history of this event, a Toyota Celica may be on its way to victory. Dan Gurney's All-American racer, Steve Millen, driving currently in number 98, teamed with Chris Cord, the California drivers, are out in front by seven laps over the Ford, now being driven by Lynn St. James. And then the second Toyota Celica, Ricky Rudd at the keyboard now, is in third place. You know, there's so much motivation to win by drivers, by sponsors. But the underlying motivation here for this car is their number one driver, who is back in California, hospitalized, broken feet, broken ankles after a practice crash 1 week ago at Riverside, California. There's a sign in the pit area for the All-American racers dedicated to the man who they want to win this race for. As you watch number 98 scurrying through the infield, Dennis Ozzie is the man they want to come home first for in this event. Dennis had done the testing on the car, and then before he could come here, had that serious crash at turn five. So, as it stands, we have Toyotas running first and third, and sandwiched in between the Lynn St. James, Tom Gloy, Bill Elliott car. Incidentally, the Ford of Gregg and Pruitt with Bob Aiken Jr. is back in fourth position. We'll be back with more of the story of Daytona after these words.
P-Pit Communication Center, headline story here, big romp and stomp Porsches in a tremendous battle for the lead. In the shadow of that story, a great battle for the smallest cars in the race, the GTU division. I like the story of the 75 car, a seven-year-old Mazda RX-7. Talk about a history, it's won four championships, six 24-hour races, defending champion in the event. Right now, Bart Kendall is driving, the defending series champion. His brother, Tom Kendall, is out of the car. They have a little motor problem. They're running at about 80% capacity. They're a couple of laps down to the lead car. And with the lead car story, let's go to Jerry Garrett.
Well, down here, Amos Johnson's the lead driver on this team. And it seems like it's been a pretty routine run for you guys.
We had to replace a starter motor in the middle of the night. Other than that, it's been pretty straightforward. We haven't had any unscheduled pit stops. We just got through doing our 2,000-mile stop, I guess you'd call it, and that should get us to the end of the race, except for just putting gas in it. We put new tires on it, new brakes on it. I'll get in the car and run the last probably 3 hours.
Okay, well, I'm sure that Kendall car is going to keep you guys honest.
Well, that is your GTU division story, and meanwhile, the 75 car has just blown up. That is the 75 car, the second place car in the GTU division. It is stopped, and it looks like Bart Kendall is climbing out, so Amos Johnson may well be home free. That's that old seven-year-old warhorse, but it looks like it's run out of oats as Kendall climbs out of it. Quickly, let's wrap it up here. The Porsches are battling up front, and the Bell Robinson Unser team has a narrow lead over Foyt, Unser, and Sullivan. Stay tuned with the Superstation as Fire Creek continues, starring Henry Fonda and Dean Jagger. We'll be back at 12:22 Eastern Time.
24 Hours of Daytona is brought to you by Budweiser, the genuine article. Beechwood Age for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. And by BF Goodrich TA Radials. TA Radials, tested tough to make your car perform.
With 3 hours and 12 minutes remaining, it is the closest 24-hour race in Daytona history. A minute and a half separating the first-place car, Dell, Unser Jr., and Robinson from A.J. Foyt, Al Unser Sr., and Danny Sullivan. There you see the top five, all Porsche 962s, 15 of them started. Six remain in the top 10 at this time. Bill Adam along with Ken Squire.
We've got a great GTO battle shaping up too, Ken. The Toyotas are showing absolutely amazing speed and reliability, and they're beating Ford at their own game. First and third, Ford is second, but very close.
Lynn St. James in that Ford running at eighth place. A.J. Foyt's car was in just moments ago for this pit stop that we recorded. The A.J. Foyt automobile, car number one, coming in, and there's a change of drivers here. Danny Sullivan stepping out, coming into the car. They came in early, incidentally, by some 10 laps. There was a flat tire on the car. And at this moment, Al Unser Sr. took controls. And as we look at the race, we have Unser against Unser, father against son, battling here in the waning moments of this 1987 24 Hours of Daytona. Left rear tire there, and there's your leader again. That's the Al Hulbert car, Derek Bell of Great Britain, Al Unser Jr. at the controls. Here's the story from Jerry Garrett.
Well, down here between the two pits for the Al Unser Sr. and the Al Unser Sr. crews, we noticed that Al Unser Sr. is reeling in his son about 3 seconds a lap. He's got the boost up, that's why. But he knows that's the slow way to do it. The quick way to do it is going to be to make up time here in the pits. They got three pit stops, all routine left to go. By getting in and out quickly, they can make up big chunks of time. And that's where these teams figure the race is going to be won or lost right now. For more on that story, let's hear Chris Economaki's report.
Back in the days when A.J. Foyt started racing, you loaded your car up on the trailer in the morning, went to the track, threw dirt at your contestants, put it back on the trailer, we're home in 12, 14 hours. Here at Daytona is the chart of the number one cars today. 20 pit stops have been made, a low of 49.1 seconds, a high of 4 minutes, 15 seconds, and every item that's been performed on the car is logged here. In fact, what's to happen on the next pit stop is here, and we don't know what time it's coming in. It's very organized. This method established years ago by Peter Gregg, a great endurance driver, and the system is still being used today.
More from Daytona coming up as we follow the last hours of the 24 hours in the Silver Anniversary Race. Superstars, Foyts, Unser, Sullivans. It's also a race for some 200 other drivers. Who are they?
Oral surgeon, airline pilot,
advertising executive,
it's committee staff, United States Senate,
professor of pediatric ophthalmology.
I hope you know I'm an actor.
Garbage man.
I don't care if you're 20 years old or 70 years old, the name Unser means something to you for a race fan. For five decades, the name has been in the headlines, starting with Uncle Louie, the grand old man of the mountain at Pikes Peak, won there in the 30s. Bobby Unser, three times Indy winner, many times. And now we have Al Sr., three times Indy winner on the track against his son, Al Jr., Can-Am champ, at 82 at Indy, and now he's out there trying to get even, break the tie that exists between father and son in the race today. Okay, stay tuned to the Superstation as Fire Creek starring James Stewart and Henry Farda continues. The next 24-hour update at 1:34 p.m. Eastern.
Daytona is brought to you by Budweiser, the genuine article. Beechwood aged for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. And by BF Goodrich TA Radials. TA Radials, tested tough to make your car perform.
Just 2 hours remain for the 32 cars left of the 69 that started at 3:30 yesterday. And car 14 is in the lead, and they had an ace up their sleeve, and that ace is playing right now. His name, Al Hulbert. The man who owns the car, who was not going to drive, has just relieved Al Unser Jr. in car 14. The heat, it's back up into the 70s. It nearly froze up last night down to 34 degrees. And that heat has been terribly debilitating on both of the top teams, which are now separated by just 43 seconds. Let's take a look at that last pit stop when car 14 came in. The leaders in the lead lap
just seconds apart. The closest finish has been 1 minute 49 seconds just 1 year ago when Hulbert's team came from 21 laps down to win. Now you see that Al Hulbert is in, and then he was away. What's the reaction of the team in second place? Jerry Garrett had that story.
Jay, it looks like Al Hulbert's played his ace. He put a fresh driver himself in the car to sprint to the finish. What do you think about that?
I'm going to have to sprint myself.
You're going to get in shortly and go to the finish. Is it going to be, are you tired?
Well, yeah, we've been up all night. All of us racing, you know, we had some problems during the, you know, night hours, but everybody had problems. But, yeah, he's fresh, so he'll be all right.
I guess the question everybody wants to know is, can you win it?
Well, we're not leading now, but we're not giving up either.
Okay, well, AJ never gives up.
Supertech has teammate Al Unser Sr. in the car. There you see the team waiting for Unser to come in. Foyt will then clamber into the car for the last moments of the race. There's AJ's car. We'll be back with more from Daytona in a moment. Status report on these leaders. Jerry Garrett, what's your summation of what's happening with these first and second place cars?
Well, as you mentioned, Ken, the heat factor is really something. For it to have been so cold and now so hot, it really has taken it out of the drivers. And a two-hour stint, you're like a limp dish rag.
Did Unser Jr. stagger away from that car?
I've never seen him so tired coming out of a race car in 5 or 6 years of watching him race.
And he was the one in the 14. Look at the smoke barreling out of the back of that lead automobile. That's been going on for a couple of hours, apparently not a problem. Let's get a word from Chris Economaki. Chris, how do you see it?
Yeah, well, I think that the big difference here is the speed. They're going to go 150 miles further this year than they did last year. Remember, there's almost double the amount of darkness at Daytona than at Le Mans. It's truly one of the toughest endurance races in the world.
To the STP Pit Center, Dave Despain.
Quick review of some of our other classes. The smallest cars in the field, Johnson, Shaw, and Lazier now have a 15-lap lead in GTU. GTO, big surprise. The Toyotas have never led this race 22 hours into it. Millen and Cord have a 69-lap lead. Biggest comeback of the race. Bell, Klein, and Earl in the GT light class, the GTB light class. And we're going to talk more about that, I believe, in our next report. It's quite a story what these guys have been through in the night. I like the race for second. Talk about a battle of corporate giants. We have here 53-year-old Augie Pabst of Brewing Company fame racing diligently for second place with Chip Mead. Yes, that is the paper company Mead. That's the race for second and third. But the big story is Bell, Klein, and Earl. And we're going to get that for you in our next report, which will be back in 35 minutes. That is at 2:14.
The best cooks know that in order for a dish to be truly exceptional, it requires three essential ingredients. One part skill, one part art, and one part...
Daytona is brought to you by Budweiser, the genuine article. Beechwood aged for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. And by B.F. Goodrich TA Radials. TA Radials, tested tough to make your car perform.
1 hour, 20 minutes remaining in just two more laps. They will be breaking records here at Daytona for distance coverage in this Silver Anniversary Classic. At 111 miles per hour, the lead right now belongs to the Al Hulbert car. Al himself is driving. He has a 1 minute, 33 second advantage over the A.J. Foyt car, and Supertex himself is at the wheel. Then the Lowry car is running third. The Dyson car is in fourth, and it is the Adams-Hotchkiss car running fifth with Bob Aiken's 962 back in sixth position. There's a great story developing in Camel Lights. It started this morning about 6:30. The car number 01, the Spice Engineering Pontiac Fiero, is now back in front, but at 6:30 this morning they had a 28 lap lead. Then Don Bell spun off pit road, hit the wall. They took 16 laps to fix the car. Then they led by 12 laps. It had Jeff Klein in the car. That car then died on the course. He's a pretty good mechanic. Talked to the crew. They got it fixed. Got onto pit road. Made repairs. They lost 19 laps. Fell to third. And now, lo and behold, they're back leading in the Camel Light Series. More from the 24 hours of Daytona in a moment. Make it two in a row. These cars use a lot of fuel, and Dave Despain went to find out where it all comes from.
This may look looked like a pretty ordinary gasoline pump, but this is not a typical trip down to the convenience store to fill her up. All we have here is a couple of 55-gallon drums that are about to be filled up with Union 76 racing gas. Let's take a look at this rather unusual trip to the service station. The nozzle goes in just like it would in your family car, but the meter on these pumps tends to run a little faster than the ones at the convenience store. $3 a gallon is the going rate for the Unical Racing Fuel, the official fuel of the event here. So you've got two 55-gallon drums. Let me do some quick arithmetic. What are we talking about there? $330, I guess, for a fill-up here. There are a couple of differences in this particular service station. First of all, it's full service, and it's hard to find those anymore. It looks like an ordinary service station, but in reality, it does a booming business. During the 24 hours of Daytona, they're pumping 17,000 gallons, estimated, out of this place in the course of the 24 hours. Have you ever pulled into a convenience store late at night and been irritated by those little signs that say, pay first? The biggest difference between this station and the ones you visit on the street is right here at the pump number. When you're all done and you've run up a bill of, looky there, $150, the Union 76 people will reward you if you have been diligent enough to persevere all through the night. And what do? When we're all filled up, we click the meter, and this gas is free.
A look to the GT, and there you see the car that's leading in the GTO class. A major upset happening here. It's the Dan Gurney All-American Racers. It is Chris Cord, grandson of the Cord who started the car in American Airlines, and New Zealand's Millen at the controls of that car, leading over St. James, Gloy, and Elliott in second place, nine laps down. Can they hold on? Last year they broke transmissions. This year it seems to be staying together for them. Remember, 3:05, we'll be back with you, and we'll have a Valvoline update to tell you about the 24 hours. In the 25th anniversary edition of the 24 hours of Daytona, the final pit stop for the leader. Clambering out of the car, 46-time IMSA winner Al Holbert, the man who brought his team to victory here 1 year ago. Derek Bell of Great Britain, two-time world champion, gets himself into this $500,000 Porsche 962. Bell, the two-time world champion, to try and bring the car home. The window knocked out. The car beginning to show a lot of smoke as the engine loosens up. But for the moment, as Al Holbert steps away, Derek Bell has control of this race and is trying to bring it home to give Al Holbert and his American team two wins in a row here at the 24 hours of Daytona.
Sports presentation of the 24 hours of Daytona is brought to you by Dodge, setting new standards of performance, and by BF Goodrich TA Radials. TA Radials, tested tough to make your car perform. And by Budweiser, the genuine article, Beechwood Age for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you.
It is a remarkable contest, this silver anniversary 24-hour endurance program here at Daytona. As we get down to the final moments, good afternoon. I'm Ken Squire, and alongside is Bill Adam, who gave it his best shot in one of those Corvettes. And as matters now stand, the number 14 car is in front, and the car that was chasing it, well, the story there, about 40 minutes ago, A.J. Foyt's car developed a death rattle. And then, just moments ago, the car finally had a glitch and stopped on course. A.J.'s car is coming down in the standings at the present time. Let's look at what happened to A.J.'s car, number 14, earlier here, just moments ago.
The number 14 car had been sounding worse and worse for maybe 20 minutes before it went away.
Yeah, it was really unfortunate that after running such a tremendous pace early on, that I think it finally took a toll. And we had talked earlier about this incredibly high boost, the very fast race pressure that went on, and here was what happened.
There's AJ clambering out of the car and asking for the record, put the car on the hook, which would eliminate it. As matters now stand, he has fallen to fourth. Now remember, it's distance covered in the elapsed time, so he can still finish up in the standings. But here's the car everyone is talking about. Al Hobert looking to win two in a row, the first man to do so since 1975, 1976, and the late, great Peter Gregg. There's battles in all four classes that have been remarkable, and I think we're getting a lead change in GTO at this very moment. Let's go to Dave Despain, who can update us on the other classifications of racing here in the 24 Hours of Daytona.
Thank you, Ken. We talked at the top of the show about the fact that there would be four races within a race, and we've had spectacular action in all four divisions. Let's quickly give you the headline stories here and then get into it in a little more depth. Al Hobert tried for 10 years to win this race before he got his first one last year. Now it looks like he's going to get two in a row. Bob Aiken, who will join us in a moment, said it would be the eighth wonder of the world if anybody upset the Porsches here. It looks like it's going to be a six-car sweep for the German juggernauts in the GTP class. GT Light Division, best comeback of the race, Don Bell, Jeff Klein, and Bob Earl. Leading by 26 laps, trouble. They fell seven laps behind. They've made it all back up, and it looks like they're going to win it going away. The drama right now is in the GTO division. Toyota had never led in this class. I have just been informed that Toyota has lost the lead. Here's the story. They've come here for years doing battle in this competition, racing the Fords and the Chevys, the big American-built iron, the stock cars, if you will, that dominate in this class. Those little Toyotas paid their dues, and this year they ironed out all the bugs. They got the transmission that would go the distance, and they have led this thing all through the night, all through the day today, and now, 45 minutes from the finish, the suspension broke on the car driven by Steve Millen and Chris Cord. Frantic repair, but just moments ago, in fact, since we began to speak, they have fallen to second place. The lead goes to Lynn St. James, Tom Gloy, and the stock car hero, Bill Elliott. The Ford Mustang has taken the GTO lead. And finally, we take you down to the smallest cars in the field, the little GTU division, dominated by the Mazdas. And again, they have come through here. Amos Johnson, Dennis Weaver, and Bob Lazier are en route to what looks like it will be a very impressive victory. That's sort of the headline, if you will, the cream off the top of a wonderful 24-hour story. We want to take a look back a little further into some of the highlights and so forth. Let's go back up topside to Ken Squire.
Indeed, for the moment, as we watch Al Hobert's team with Derek Bell now at the controls trying to win this event, let's take a look at the highlights that we have seen in the past 24 hours of competition. On the 3.56-mile track at about 3:30 yesterday afternoon, a field of some 69 cars rolled out. And right at the start, Bruce Levens beautifully turned out number 86, took the lead. But here was the car to watch. The 52, the American Hope, the Chevrolet Corvette, battled with the 86. And there you saw the number 52 going by, going out in front, Cyril Vandemerver in the Corvette, the prototype Corvette. Here once again was Klaus Ludwig on the attack and taking the position back in the 11 Porsche 962. A great dice up in front in the early going. Back to the 31 degree banking they traveled. Later on, you see the Corvette just barely off course. Then the car was in. Driver change here, and Doc Bundy of Atlanta, Georgia, assuming control. The Jaguar put up a great scrap in the early going. This is car number 44, the Tullius Jaguar, which was up at the top five in the early going until about midnight. Great battle here. That's the Dyson, car number 16. Price Cobb making this incredible move on the outside to take the lead.
Really spectacular. This is hard break at this point. 200 miles an hour, right down to 50.
Now there's one of the Ford cars in trouble, watching Scott Pruitt call it a day in the Pro. Darkness beginning to settle over the Daytona Speedway at 6:02, the sunset last night, and there was trouble in the infield. Here's Lanny Hester's car, winner in GTO a year ago, catching on fire. He was not to win it again this year. There were other fires during the night as well in automobiles, but none perhaps not as dramatic as the Lanny Hester incident. In the going, here's the Jim Busby car, number 67, the B.F. Goodrich car. They had gone as far as third. Remember, they finished third a year ago. They had valve trouble before the race was over and were not to finish this event. They had been right up in the top three in the first 8 or 9 hours of competition. It was a broken valve that put them away. Now here is Derek Bell just around Don. They blew a tire coming through the 180-mile-per-hour portion of the course. He was able to get the car on pit road, make the tire change. No dramatic charge like a year ago from 21 laps back. Here was the story throughout the morning. A.J. Foyt, Unser Sr. and Sullivan, and look what happens to the Scott Pruitt car. The Roush Mustang loses the nose. I've heard of getting your doors blown off, but never the front end of your car. They were able to repair this car, number 22, get it back in competition after this remarkable incident in the Tri-Oval. Incidentally, that number 22 is currently in third place in GTO. Then it was Hulbert back in front. And it was Hulbert to take over the driving chores. He'd been listed only as owner, but right now he may be on his way to his 47th win. At one time, the interval between first and second was just down to 43 seconds. A year ago, in the closest 24 hours in history, it was decided by 1 minute and 49 seconds. Not to be then, not to be this year, as that number one is now out of the race. Here's that Cord car, Chris Cord and Millen, who had been leading in GTO until just as we came on the air. This is the lightweight car. There's the 01 that's been leading in the Camel Light Series through most of the going. Fell all the way back in the ninth. They went back to 19th position at Don. They have gone back in first place, Bob Earl and company, in that Camel Light Pontiac Fiero. It's been a great race to date, and until just a few moments ago, that's car number 71 in the Amos Johnson team. There's the Kendall car with whom they fought through almost 6 straight hours. They were in the same lap, but say goodnight to the Kendall car, and it looks like Amos Johnson and Shaw, Dennis Shaw, are on their way once again. Now here's that final driver change. Derek Bell about to get in the car and replace Al Hulbert. That's Al Hulbert getting in. Correction, I'm sorry. Al Hulbert getting in here, relieving Unser Jr., who was really fit to be tied, very exhausted at that point in the race. Not much air conditioning in those cars. Those little side windows, $700, and both the leader and the second place car broke them out trying to get more air into those machines, but it also raises havoc with the aerodynamics as they clear the banking on this 31 degree east and west end of the Daytona Speedway.
Well, it's a problem because a race like this takes such a toll on driver fatigue. You really have to play a give and take game. Do you sacrifice a little aerodynamics to make the driver more comfortable? Very important.
The five-time IMSA champion, Al Hulbert, is standing by on pit road with Jerry Garrett.
We're down here with Al Hulbert right now, and Al, it would seem that your strategy has been vindicated in this particular race. You're way out in front.
Well, we are, but I have to say that I've been a racing fan and a person involved for a long time, and I've never met a tougher competitor or more of a gentleman than A.J. Foyt, and that's a newly found opinion, and I really respect him and his team.
Is it nice to go out there and race with him? I guess it's kind of a fulfillment of a dream for you to race guys like that.
Well, it's good fun, and I had a taste of that years ago in the IROC, and it was certainly a thrill, and it still is, and certainly this is our turf, so to speak, and I welcome him, you know, to make an effort like he has, and of course all our other good customers, Porsche supporters who've done a wonderful job too, but I just feel that just that extra special feeling about him right now.
Okay, well, we'll be back with more from the 24 Hours of Daytona right after this.
Down on the first event of Speed Weeks 1987 here at the World Center of Speed. The 24 Hours of Daytona looks to be the property of Al Hulbert and company. Massive crowd in the infield, and there you see the number 14 going for two in a row at this point. I think for me, however, the most exciting moments, there's so many stories within this race, we've had such a good race up in front, is the GTO story that is being told by Dan Gurney's All-American race team. That Toyota Celica, that car number 98 that's now on pit road, That car is like a Sugar Ray Leonard up against a Larry Holmes. Little 124cc engine, a cubic inch engine against the 310s, up to 400 cubic inch power plants. And it has led so much of the way for Gurney and company in a race they dedicated to one of the fine drivers in American motorsport, Dennis Ozzie, who we hope is watching and enjoying our coverage today. Dennis, everybody here misses you. As you know, Dennis crashed in practice, broke both his ankles in Riverside, California, a week ago, getting the car ready to stay right up in second position. Here's the number 14 staying in front. Dan Gurney came here in 1962 in a three-hour race that started this series back in the early days. Remember that, where he beat Bill Hill when he just cranked that old Lotus and brought it across the line at the last moment, parked against the wall? They wouldn't let you do that these days, Bill.
I remember that so well. I was a real motor racing fan at that point. Gurney was and still continues to be a hero. Wonderful.
Let's go to Dan Gurney with Chris Economaki.
Dan, you remember back in 1962, you were parked up there. How long did you wait before you pulled it across the McKee?
About a minute and a half. It had a connecting rod sticking out through the side of the engine. All I had to do was turn left and roll down the hill.
Okay, and you wanted on it. Right now, you got problems here. Over the years, has there ever been a 10-foot like this? Your car was waiting until 1 minute ago, and now it's not, I understand.
That's right. And a small failure. It's been a hard struggle for 23 hours and 40-some minutes.
What's the situation with the car right now?
It's out there running right now. We had about a 7-lap lead about 20 minutes ago.
Okay, so Dan Gurney's concerned about this car. We appreciate him taking time to talk with us. Back to you.
And there is the car, which is currently being shown in second place. And up in front, Lynn St. James, the SCCA Trans Am champion a couple of years back, Tom Loy, and Million Dollar Bill, Bill Elliott, leading in car number 11. But the Toyota Celica has really made history here today, running 24 hours. It's still in the hunt.
Well, it really has been a most impressive performance, and Toyota's had such adversity this week, overcoming the loss of Dennis for quite a few months. He'll be out, of course, unfortunately. But the car, as you say, it really is competing here with a small engine. It doesn't have the big cubic inch V8 engine of an American car. It doesn't have the backup. Roush has, what, 5-6 cars here? There are two Toyotas, and they've both been so impressive.
Let's check on other motorsports news around the country. Bob Barsha is standing by with a GM Goodwrench update.
Thanks, Ken. Well, out in Arizona, the Parker 400 has become the latest triumph in the career of racing prodigy Robbie Gordon. Co-driving with his father, Bob, young Robbie, a teenager, came from behind in the late going yesterday to win the Parker 400. That's the off-road season opener over a record field of over 400 entries, plus early leader Ivan Stewart. And you can imagine that that made the Gordon family one very happy bunch of people. At Anaheim, California last night, 1985 Stadium Supercross champ Jeff Ward won the opening round of that series in Anaheim, but the event was marred by a bad fall taken by last year's champ Ricky Johnson, who was knocked unconscious. The field made two laps before they could get the race stopped, but it appears that Johnson is going to be all right. Here in Florida last night, a crash-filled evening at Volusia County Speedway, not far from right here at Daytona, was marred by a tremendous 7-car spill. You'll see it right here. It was sparked by USAC midget champ Rich Vogler. Nobody hurt. Took a while to clean up, though. That was in the B main, the A main, a walkover for this guy, Bobby Davis Jr., outlaw sprint star. What a day for New Jersey's Hank Endres, a 20-year veteran of Top Fuel Racing at the Winter Nationals in California. He is the leader in the Top Fuel class. He'll meet another great comeback story, Dick LaHaye, in the first round. And finally, good weather, make that bad weather, at least bad weather for snowmobiles, is ruining the races going on up in the Northwest. It's delayed the Formula One final up in La Crosse, Wisconsin, of 200 starters in a 500-mile enduro from Thunder Bay, Ontario to Minneapolis, Minnesota. Only 95 are left. They're not sure they're going to have enough snow to finish it. We'll have the stories on these and the rest of the racing news next Friday night on Motor Week Illustrated. That's it for now from the GM Goodwrench Motor Week Illustrated Racing Update Center.
Thank you, Bob. Glorious day for car number 14. Temperature now in the mid-70s. Al Holbert and company on their way to victory here in the 24 hours of Daytona. If it can just stay together, let's see. 23 hours, 49 minutes have been completed to date as 14 continues to roll. The crowd in the infield awaiting the finish of this one to see if indeed Al Holbert's team can come through with a second streak. And we'll be back with more from Daytona after these messages. Finish upcoming. Stay tuned.
Promotional fee and consideration paid by STP. For nearly three decades, America has been driving and winning with STP.
STP is the racer's edge.
And by Mr. Goodwrench and General Motors Parts. No one knows your GM car better than Mr. Goodwrench. No one.
2,670 miles thus far covered by car number 14, averaging 5 miles plus over the record of a year ago. Just about 110.8, 105 the mark from a year ago by the same racing team that stays out in front. 8 laps over the second place car, which is another Porsche 962, Lorari Sagala Brunticelli. And in third spot is the Dyson car. Car that was leading earlier, Price Cobb and Vern Chupin of Australia. And now you can see the leaders beginning to gather up for the typical sports car Daytona finish. $263,000 at stake today. Pretty good for a sports car race, pretty meager compared to the $1.5 million for the Daytona 500 a couple of weeks hence. Yesterday, we left Chris Economaki here at the Kmart of Parts for the Porsche people. He was checking on prices and what goes on, and Chris is back there today to see how much was sold.
If you remember, yesterday I left you at this magnificent Porsche Emporium that has 30,000 parts for its 9 customers in the race. They expected a lot of business. Well, they tell me now that it's been sort of a slow weekend. No big ticket items. Business as usual. And I just asked Peter Schmitz if he's going to have a big end of race sale, and he almost had apoplexy.
We develop a lot of memories in the 5 years we've come here to cover this race. I recall the second time, I guess it was, when we were here, when Mario and Michael Andretti teamed up in the first Porsche 962 to come to America. Second generation driver at the wheel. Look at our father-son stories here today. We have Al Unser Jr. beating his father, Al Unser Sr. today when the IndyCar Super Team effort blew a motor late in the race. And just below them in fifth spot, the Johns Hotchkiss. John Jr. and John Sr., they're going to finish fifth here today. Remember Bob Aiken? Well, let's talk about that father-son story. You got to be pretty proud of the kid. Bobby Jr. is going to finish third, it looks like, in the number 22 GTO car, Bob.
Yeah, after a real shaky start, an accident on the first lap by one of his co-drivers, and they brought the car back, and then they had a colossal accident some hours ago where the whole front of the car came off, and we really had the car out in our minds anyway, but the Roush team did a fabulous job. Got the thing back together and on the track and third in class.
A painful question for me to ask, but Dad got sixth in class and the kid's gonna get third. Who buys the steak tonight?
Well, I think we're gonna see who takes the most prize money home, and we'll argue about that when we get home.
So that looks like the father-son stories may be continuing. This race is continuing right down to the wire, and we're now, I believe, inside 3 laps to go. Ken, is that right?
Something like that. We're showing 24 minutes. We're showing 23 hours, 56 minutes now complete, with about 4 minutes to go, maybe 3 laps, something like that. And the car out in front is this number 14. You know, this is going to be the second win in a row for Chip Robinson at the November IMSA finale. The International Motorsports Association, the sanctioning body, whom I might add have done a magnificent job with this race. I'm not blowing smoke. They really have done a good job. This kid Robinson has been part of the team, came home victorious with the Jaguar organization, switches teams now, and he's going to win the 24. There you see the number 3 car, Lorari Sagala, Brancatelli, second place car pulling up into the picture, and a lot of smoke continues to bellow out from that car as it has an engine continuing to loosen up. Here's Jerry Garrett.
We're down here with Jack Roush, who brought a lot of cars and had a lot of problems all night, and looks like you're going to pull it out. You wouldn't believe it.
Well, you know, the thing about these 24-hour races, it's really exceptional. If anybody can race for a whole day with having a problem occur of some kind. We had our problems early, and we fought them all night. We've never had such an uphill race. I know how sad it is for somebody like Dan Gurney's team to have their problem right at the last minute, but we felt as bad about our early problem, I'm sure, as they did their late one, except we suffered all night with ours. The drivers, Bill and Lynn and Tom, just drove fantastic. They never missed a beat. Ford Mustang was just super. I couldn't be any happier for the crew that we brought here and our new team manager, Bill Fingerlow for GTO. We just had a great day, and we're looking forward to really contesting this GTO series all year for Ford Motor Company.
Okay, thanks, Jack. We'll step back here just a little bit and keep rolling on this. The crew's got a present for Jack. That looked like a New York Giants Super Bowl play there.
I think it was.
Now there's the leader in GTO, car number 11. That's been all the way down. Remember, that car was running 34th in the early going. You talk about comebacks. In the Camel Light Series, the Pontiac Fiero has done it, and certainly this car with Tom Gloy now driving, Lynn St. James and Bill Elliott. Scott Pruitt took a turn at the wheel as well. They're leading in GTO, and it's been a magnificent battle, and certainly the Toyotas have come of age in this race.
Well, they are a very serious force now, and I think, if anything, this was the race where nobody maybe took the Toyota serious.
And they're coming down for the finish, coming to the line. As they cross the stripe, they did not get the flag that time. I think we're one away from getting the checkers on this event. And the three Porsche 962s all gathering up for a squadron-style finish.
That's right. Today's going to be the PR day for the Porsche photographers. They make all the calendars from this one. Tremendous day.
11 straight. Who's ever going to beat them? I had such hopes for Hendrick in this race. That Corvette, and everybody said, give it 2 hours, it'll be gone. And it ran a long time. That car number 52, what, had 8 hours in this race?
Well, it really may ultimately come to a point where the Corvette can challenge in a long race like this, but the Porsche factory goes through so much development and testing with their cars, and they have a facility that is unmatched in the world by General Motors, by Ford, by anyone.
And now you see the three leaders. This is a great day for Rob Dyson. He owns television stations around America, and he comes out of Poughkeepsie, New York. He loves to race. They won a couple, and they crashed. That's the number 16 that's running in third place. There you see the first place car. Then directly behind it is, it comes back on the banking, and they'll probably come three wide here, is the Italian team, Lorari, Sagala, Brancatelli, and the third car back there, that's the Dyson machine with Price Cobb and the brilliant Vern Schuppan. For my money, Schuppan's as good as anybody in the world, and he's never received the credit.
He certainly is. He is a veteran at Le Mans, has always done extremely well over there, and I think is rated as one of the more intelligent drivers.
Well, Ferrari started this years ago, back in the days of Pedro Rodriguez, when they lined up those three Ferraris to come across the line. Interested party, Lynn St. James there looking on, and she is about to have a GTO championship tagged to her name with Elliott and Gloy alongside. And now back to the banking, final time, top three cars coming around to finish the silver anniversary, 24 hours of Daytona, here on the Superstation WTBS. Here they come, three cars that have run the distance. Porsche 962s have done it. Checkered flag is out. It's over for 1987, and Speed Week's officially underway. 24 hours of hard work. You see some of the Ford team there ecstatic about their victory, and they have every right to be. They made a comeback in this race that's as good as you'll get in sports. Lynn St. James, fastest woman driver in the world. New record at Talladega. She has to be pleased. We hope to be getting a word from her very, very shortly. And with Al Hulbert, our old pal Derek Bell, Unser Jr., Chip Robinson. What a great day for all of them. We'll be back with more from Daytona. Into Victory Lane, Eastern Airlines will present Victory Lane today here on the Superstation, so please stay with us. You live here at Daytona Beach, and pulling into Victory Lane is Derek Bell of Great Britain, the two-time world champion, another time victor here at Daytona. Chris Economaki is standing by, and let's go to our Eastern Airlines interview with the champions here today.
Right here, TV.
Okay, Derek, hello again.
How are you?
I'm just fine. Golly, you're all wet. Is the roof leak?
Well, it's just that the window was open a little and it drew all the hot air in from the engine.
They tell me that you guys really got adversely affected by the climate inside the car during the course of this race. How bad was it?
Well, we just drove our hearts out the whole way, and just today, once the windscreen had gone for the window, just too bad to drive, you know, it's just too hot.
What's the problem?
Well, it sucks all the air in from the engine, you see.
compared to Le Mans, Derek? Harder or easier?
Much harder.
Really?
Oh, yeah, much.
In what way?
It's just so hard. Hard just is not a 4 mile straight, is there?
Oh, that's true. That's a restful straight, huh?
It certainly is.
Okay, you know who's here? The president of Porsche and the PR director ought to watch you take another Daytona 24 Hours victory. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Chris.
We'll be back in Victory Lane. Back to you, Ken Squire.
All right, checking on the rundown here. I gave you some misinformation. That GTO car that won came from 37th position after 4 hours. Lynn St. James, Tom Bloy, and Bill Elliott. Magnificent performance by them. As the crowd continues to gather around Victory Lane, let's go to Jerry Gibb.
Okay, well, the GTO winner, Lynn St. James, is in the car here with Bill Elliott and Tom Bloy. They're all going to go down to Victory Circle together. This is a happy crew.
Roush Racing, big success. The Chevrolet-Ford battle, it was so strong in Trans Am, continuing here in this 24-hour battle. And as you know, the Chevys had their problems in this first time out for them in IMSA racing.
Really surprising, but boy, they put up some performance. The pair of Camaros, the Peerless Camaro, and of course the beautiful Protofat cars were rockets at the start, but a long-distance race once again.
Climbing out, deep breath, and for a moment, silence over the racetrack. There are the final standings in GTO. Millencourt, the Toyota comes back for second. Aiken Jr., Pruitt, Deborah Gregg in another Mustang. And remember, that car had problems from the outset of the race. Came back to finish in third. Then Wally Dahlenbeck and Robin McCall and company. That Chevy finished up in the third position. So they weren't totally out of it today. And in fourth was Ricky Rudd and Fangio. For you stock car fans, Rudd finished fifth in this. You know, he said this was like driving a motocross machine. He said it reminded him of his old two-cycle. Here's car number 11 being pushed down toward Victory Lane to join with the Porsche 962 that has already come into that area. 2 weeks hence, big question is which of the American manufacturers will be in there in the all-American race. Here's Dave Despain.
They call this place the cradle of racing civilization. Daytona creates legends. This is one whose name you might not know if you're not an ardent follower of this sport. My friend Alvin Springer, let me tell you why he's a legend. You see the six names up here, all these Porsches that have run 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 today. He built all the motors, every one of them. He's won this race. His motors have won this race 5 years in a row. Alvin, I must ask you, what's your secret?
It's our secret. It's a good workmanship from our team at home at MLA.
How many people are involved in the actual preparations of the motors, and approximately, if you can possibly estimate it, how many man hours to get ready for this massive effort?
I would say we have about 8 people in the race shop, just the racing engines, nothing else. And we started already in the beginning of November. And just continue through with December and for January.
There is no end to your season. It goes on 12
that
months a year.
Great.
We know of the pride and the exhilaration of winning as the drivers go to Victory Lane. We see the crews jumping. Your feelings inside right now. Does your heart still flutter after winning 5 of these in a row?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And what I would like to say is that in a position like mine, you know, it's always that one guy gets the credit, but it is totally unfair because I would like to thank my total team for supporting us and the teams, you know, at the racetrack.
Racing is very much a team effort, but in a very real sense, this man, like Richard Petty, is a king here at Daytona. Our sincere congratulations
to
Alvin Springer.
Thank you.
Let's for just a moment talk about GTU and not forget that for the sixth straight year, Mazda RX-7s came home. Amos Johnson, Dennis Shaw, Bob Legier finished in first in the GTU classification, and it was Mazda first and second of Porsche 911 coming through in third spot. Great finish for those guys, Johnson and Shaw. They're just playing good racers, and they must have had a wonderful time.
Oh, they stay around, and they're always up here. It's funny, you always see the same people come back year after year, and it seems the same cars. The Mazdas are perennial winners here.
Again, here's Jerry Garrett.
Okay, well, we're down here with our colleague Lynn St. James, and I guess this has to be your biggest victory in racing.
It certainly is. My first road race as a spectator was the 24 Hours of Daytona. It's what made me fall in love with road racing, and it has been a dream to run the Daytona 24 Hour and then to win it, and so it's a culmination of a dream.
You were saying earlier to me that your hopes were pretty bleak until just a couple minutes ago.
Well, yeah, they were, because I know this happened to the Roush Racing team last year with a Mustang where they led almost the whole race, and then at the last, you know, they were dropped out or had problems, and then they came in second. So we know how the Toyota team feels, but, you know, we had to keep trying the best we could with the Mustang. I cannot believe how well that car ran. I mean, it was not perfect, But it just kept trucking, like, you know, just like a truck. It was good.
Lynn St. James, who kept on trucking here at the 24 Hours of Daytona, and with Bill Elliott and Tom Loy, are victorious in GTO. We'll be back with more interviews, more of the story of the Silver Anniversary, Twice Round the Clock Classic, in a moment. In the Al Hulbert team, second straight year, first person to have a team that's won it back-to-back since the late Peter Gregg back in the mid-70s. Congratulations to him. Let's go back to the Eastern Airlines Victory Lane area, and standing by is Jerry Garrett.
We are looking at the three winners in the GTU class, Bob Lazier, Amos Johnson, and Dennis Shaw. And Amos, this is the third time that you've been involved with a winner at Daytona in the last 3 years.
That's right. This car, this chassis, as a matter of fact, 3 years in a row, and we just wouldn't let ourselves believe it was going to happen again until we knew that even if it broke, nobody could catch us the last half hour. And then I turned in a couple of quick laps just for fun.
Okay, well, congratulations to you. And we should also mention congratulations to the Camel Lights class winners, Jeff Klein, Bob Earl, and Don Bell.
Thank you, Jerry. Well, it's time for our reporter's roundtable here. Even though you were driving, you certainly qualify. What about it, Bill Adam? What stands out about this Silver Anniversary 24 to you?
An incredible pace to this race, but I'm very, very happy for Chip Robinson, one of the co-winners in the Hulbert Racing Team. Chip probably has to be the most envied driver in North America right now. He is on with the perfect team, Hulbert Racing. They've done it again.
Let's join the a cappella choir down there at the STP Pit Center. David?
I always so much enjoy this broadcasting brouhaha that wraps up the 24 Hours of Daytona. Everybody gets to express an opinion, whether it makes a lick of sense or not. We'll start with the guy who just saw his first 24 Hours. Bob Richards, how are you going to remember this thing?
Well, Dave, of course, I worked last night, and seeing the incredible punishment that these cars take, watching them in the pit stops with those turbochargers coming in glowing red in the night, that's a picture I'll remember for a long time.
Chris Economaki has missed a grand total of one. Can we come all the way to the other end of the line to the guy who has seen 24 of 25 of these races? Chris, how do you remember this one?
Well, it's longer than the other ones. I remember that. It's still 24 hours, but it seems to be longer. No, it's much more professional. It's much faster. It's much more trying, both on the men and on the machines. It's much more business-like. It was a fun, sporty thing at the outset. Now it's very, very serious business.
Bill Hennessey from the pits on the night shift.
Well, I was glad that you gave recognition to Alvin Springer, who built all the motors for Porsche, but the unsung heroes are the guys that work in the pits and replace the starters, replace the brakes during the night, and really jeopardize their personal safety during the running of a 24 Hours of Daytona to see the checkered flag.
I have a bit of a logistical problem. Jerry Garrett has just joined us way back at the other end of the line. Is it appropriate for us to go back up? Are you out of breath, or are you able to talk to us, Jerry?
Well, a little bit of both.
Your memories.
I know that in this particular race that I've probably seen the stereotypical A.J. Foyt performance. Everybody wonders if the fire's gone out for this guy at 52 years of age. No, he'd still rather win or blow up.
Exactly. And we move on down the line. Bob Aiken has been my colleague here in the STP Pit Center. Bob?
Well, the eighth wonder of the world didn't occur, Dave. Porsche didn't get beat again in the or for once in the Daytona 24-hour, but several teams put up a good show. I thought Bob Tullius' Jaguar team did a great job, and the Hendrick Chevy Corvette team looked good. And one of these days, we're going to have some problems on our hands.
This comes from a Porsche owner driver. Steve Potter was also on that night shift along pit road. Steve, how about it?
My memory is going to be of that Corvette GTP car, even though it only went 15 hours. I think it showed that it's going to be a tough competitor in the next 16 races on the Camel Circuit.
And Bob Varsha, wrap it up for us, if you will.
Well, like Bob Richards, Dave, I was up through the night, and you know as well as I do, you've got to stay up through the night to get the real feeling of a 24 hours. I'll remember Brian Redmond climbing out of that flaming Porsche on the infield, the great battle Danny Sullivan and Chip Robinson had while Foyt's team was trying to forge that lead before it all went up in smoke. But I tell you, the guy I'm going to remember is Jack Roush. When that Mustang was down, they kept plugging, kept putting it back together. At about dawn, he said, we're just going to drive it in the ground. The Celicas look bulletproof, but we're going to keep trying. And slowly, they got right back up there where they've been for the past couple of years, winning another 24 hours. I like Jack Roush a lot.
You know, I like the fond memories of Daytona so much, but I have to recall the other side of that story, because for Dan Gurney, who won the first race here, to come here with that Toyota and to battle so valiantly all through the night and to get within 30 minutes of the finish and then have a car break must be a heartbreak. I just got a bit of good news. We've got a little more time. Let me go back to Chris Economaki, if I may. Chris, the issue of race strategy. Are 24-hour races changing in their nature? Are they becoming more of a sprint race? Or is that basic strategy you saw in your first one 25 years ago still essentially the same?
Well, the equipment is so much better. It can stand so much more. But the winning car, for example, had not Al Holbert been available at the last minute, all three of those drivers were ill from fumes. They couldn't continue. Al had to get in on 15 minutes' notice. Al is a very serious guy. He wants time to mentally prepare. He didn't have it. He got in the car and he won with it. If Al hadn't have been there, it might have been another story. So that's what's happened to this business. It's go, go, go all the time.
And business it very much is. The issue of dollars certainly comes to mind when you start talking, Bob Aiken, about racing. Cars that cost, we hear all kinds of figures, $300,000, $400,000, $500,000. The money spent here this weekend is mind-boggling.
Yeah, we figured out last year, Dave, it cost us $10,000 an hour to run our car. And with the change in the dollar and the Deutschmark relationship, that's probably gone up another 20-30% in the last month.
You know, one of the things I like about this broadcast team is the enthusiasm that pervades. Down here, a man who has come here for 25 years, as we said, and yet as we approach the time to go off the air, he's doing this because he wants to talk some more. Chris, take it away.
No, but Bob talked about $10,000 an hour. Peter Schutz, the president of Porsche, just landed out here a couple hours ago. He got here to get into Victory Lane, and, you know, in addition to being a racing fan, he's selling Porsche cars and parts, and that's why he's here. It's a good account.
Well, he should be here. He should be here. This is where the money is, obviously.
They're telling me that the poor boys in the booth are feeling a bit left out, so I guess we ought to toss it back to the fellows who watched it all from up topside, Ken Squire and Bill Adam. Thank you all so much.
Oh, excuse me. Are they done down there?
I think so.
Let's take a look and talk about records for a moment. 2,534 miles recovered 1 year ago. This year, 2,684 as they stretched right out and did edge work to the last moment in that Porsche 962 number 14.
Well, it's an incredible increase. You just don't make leaps like this, but it's a good indication of just how hot and heavy that pace was.
There were 30 cars that finished of the 69 that started, and let's take a look at the leaderboard right now as to who the top 10 overall were in this event. And there you've got them. The lead automobile, of course, at the finish is the Al Holbert car. Magnificent performance by Holbert and company here. Lauri Segala, Brancatelli in second. Dyson comes in with the third place car, and then it's the A.J. Foyt team, followed by the Hotchkiss machine and Bob Aiken's car in sixth. And in seventh overall was Lynn St. James, Gloyne Elliott with the Roush Ford, that GTO, followed by Cord and Mullen for Dan Gurney. We'll be back with more from the 24 Hours of Daytona following these messages.